and welcome to another exciting broadcast day.
Oh, how right you are. Phone number 866-901-ADAM. 866-901-ADAM. We've been on vacation, or we were on vacation for a few weeks. We're back yesterday. I didn't get a chance to talk to enough of you, so give me a call. It's not that I'm interested in hearing from you, I got to be honest, but you're just fodder. You're grist for my mill. Call in. Make an ass of yourself. Tell me what you're thinking. I do like talking to people as much as I don't like talking to people. I got to tell you, I'll get this in hopefully before my mom wakes up this morning, but I swear to God, my 4th of July was all but destroyed because of I've been working on this movie 12 hours a day, 6 days a week. And I don't mean euphemistically 12 hours a day. I mean more like 13 hours a day for 6 days a week. I've never been more busy in my life. The 4th of July came around and here's what I find. I find I normally just want to be left alone, but people won't let me leave them alone. It just never ends. What ends up happening is I announced to the wife on the 4th of July, I have one day off. This is it. I'll be doing double shifts for the next 2 weeks. I'll be doing this radio show and then I'll be shooting my movie. I would love nothing more than to sit in my home and stare at the ceiling for 18 hours and then begin the grind again. I don't want to do anything. I don't want people coming over. I don't want to go anywhere. I don't want to do anything. And there's a couple of phone calls, couple people want to come by. Now, I live in a house where you can see the fireworks from my house. I'm up on the hill. It's not like you're standing out on the softball diamond where they're being lit off, but it's pretty good considering you're inside your house and you're watching the fireworks. So every 4th of July, the phone will ring and people want to know, hey, how's it going? You guys, anyone coming by? How about we come by, you know, take a look at the fireworks. So I put the kibosh on this at noon or the night before. I just say to the old lady, I'm watching the TiVo. I'm going to crack a beer. I'm going to putz around. Oh, you know, that thing people come by. Listen, we'll eat. We don't need any, you know, we don't need anything. We'll bring a six pack, all that stuff. But you got to put the house together. You got to put yourself together, so on and so forth. So I make the announcement now. So again, Oswaldo calls. I got angry at Oswaldo driving home last night at 7 o'clock at night from the set of the movie, thinking he came over not only to ask me about some paperwork, but to get a check for me, although I see him the following morning at 6 a.m., and it's 4th of July. You really need the goddamn check? You're going to hammer the check at noon on the 4th of July? You can't wait till 8 a.m. the following morning. But my mom is calling all morning. My mom's calling. She wants to see the kids. She's in love with the twins. God bless her. Not going to hold it against her, but she calls the wife. She calls me. Ozzy's calling all morning. And so are all the people who want to come over and hang out and watch the 4th. I make the announcement to the old lady. Just don't pick up the phone. Just look, I don't want to deal with any. I don't want to be rude to anybody. I don't want to get into it. Look, I just need some time. You can see the twins some other time. Just don't pick the phone up. In which case, Ozzy shows up at my house at 12:30 in the afternoon, actually inside the house. When I ask him what he's doing inside my house, he explains he called. No, when I say to him, why didn't you call? Don't you call? You just come over? He goes, yeah, I called. You didn't pick up. I get rid of Oswaldo, and as I'm looking out the window, I see my mom rolling up the driveway. She called. Nobody answered, so she's swinging by, too. Now the phone never stops ringing about what's going on. Finally, someone breaks through to my wife, and next thing you know, we have three couples coming over to watch the fireworks show. So I tried to essentially, the solution is really for me to kill myself, because me just not answering the phone and making the announcement to people, look, I'm not home, I want to be left alone, that's not good enough, evidently.
How did I know?
Short of killing yourself, would it be possible to leave an outgoing message that says, listen, it's the 4th of July, I'm calling it off. Don't come over. Don't stop by.
It's the idea that the phone gets hung. You know, I get a phone call. I don't pick up the phone. The phone gets hung up. My wife gets phone calls. She doesn't. Then the cell phones start ringing. Eventually, people whip themselves up into some sort of thing where it's like I'm an infirmed old woman who may have taken a spill in the kitchen, and they have to come over with the flashlight and Lassie to figure out what's going on. They become concerned citizens at a certain point. Well, he's not picking his cell phone up. I'm heading over there. I, by the way, for the record, head nowhere when nobody picks up the phone. If I call a muffler shop and they don't pick up, I don't head over. If I call my mom, she doesn't pick up, I don't head over. I don't head over. What is that instinct? Ah, they're not picking up. I'm heading over. What do you think? I'm bound and gagged somewhere. couple of Shiite terrorists pacing up and down. I'm wearing a vest with plastique explosive.
Your mother had the sawed-off shotgun in case the door was locked. She was going to ram it in.
Hit it with the butt of the gun and then shoulder roll and snap up into the prone position.
Give me back my son.
She does the cock with the one hand on the shotgun where she pumps it while she's riding the Harley.
It's too bad you have so many people who love you and want to see you.
I know. It's brutal.
It's horrible. I'm sorry.
Then they come over, and I'm angry, and I'm yelling at Ozzy. And, of course, Ozzy presents me paperwork from his home country, from when he worked at the Winchells in Nicaragua. He'll show me 1978. He'll show, what is this? I don't know what this is. Well, how do I? Ozzy always needs to know how he gets paid, what's going on. He'll show me stuff from the radio. He'll show me a pay stub from the radio station. He'll present receipts from popcorn and box office from a movie he reviewed 3 weeks ago. What's going on in my house on a weekend? What do I do? And I yell at him every time. Go talk to producer Angie. Talk to Angie. Talk to her on Monday. What do you want me to do? Hold on a second. I'm going to reach into my pocket, undo the rubber band around the billfold, start flipping. See, what do we got? Story two. And then lift the shirt up. I got the change maker. And 37 cents. There you go. A receipt comes out of my ass that says free FM on it. What the hell?
You're the only one he trusts.
I don't know. I know I sound like the world's biggest Grinch, but can a man just be left alone when he needs to be left alone on a 4th of July?
That's a long day. Was that your first day doing both the radio show and the movie in one day?
Yeah, yesterday was. It was, about a 16-hour day. I knew what I got into it when I signed up, but that I also knew that the day before this was I wanted to be in one of those altered states isolation deprivation tanks where I'm just floating in salt water and my mind is spinning out like it's on peyote
with a waterproof TiVo in there.
Yeah. Ooh. Write that down.
I will.
So anyway, that was my fourth.
I hate to sound like a Grinch or the Independence Day.
Then you'd sound like Adam. That would be so weird.
Yeah, that's true. Now listen, I'm folksy. I like folksy and quaint and all that sort of thing. I love that sort of stuff. So don't get me wrong. But is everyone? What is it with the fireworks? Why do people travel great distances to see fireworks? Why do people fight tens of thousands of people to gather to watch fireworks? Aren't we past fireworks? What is exciting about seeing them in '06?
I'll tell you the thing about fireworks. First off, no alterations from a technological standpoint in over 1,000 years. It is
exactly.
One of the things. Fireworks and saddle making, I would say, are the two things that have remained untouched by the human hand.
And sippy cup.
And the sippy cup. Over 1,000 years.
The plastic lid you get at the coffee store, that little hole that is ineffectual. I make cries against that plastic thing.
Here's how you know.
We gotta improve on that.
Here's how you know your technology is not pushed ahead. If they're making a movie about something that took place 200 years ago, like if you're making a Western, you just send some PA, go get a saddle and bring it back. You don't go get one of those old fangled saddles
from the specialty store.
Yeah, just go, you don't go get an antique saddle, you just go get a saddle. And if you say go get fireworks, you could be making a movie about China in the 1100s. And you go, just go down to the Red Devil shack over there and get some sparklers. It hasn't changed. You think by now they'd be able to do your initials up there or will you marry me or something good like that. It has remained unchanged. But I'll tell you what people like about fireworks. It's not effed out. Everything else in our society we used to wait once a year for. Like we grew up, you'd watch The Grinch That Stole Christmas once a year. It came on the 17th of December, or it was Frosty the Snowman, and you waited in front of the TV. Now, every little punk has a DVD of it, and it means nothing to them anymore. Fireworks, they've somehow pretty much just limited them to the 4th of July. Oh, sure, after an All-Star game, they'll light a few off. You see it on your TV set. And once in a while, they pop one off over at the Hollywood Bowl. But by and large, the average American sees a fireworks show in the flesh once a year. And therefore, we always just stand there like retarded dogs with our jaws flapped open. If they did it every weekend, if they did what they did with other things where it's like, and then fireworks show. You know, if they did like, well, we do the boat show, then the fireworks show. We do the ball game, then the fireworks. They did it all the time. You'd be like, fat.
Yes. You're right.
You'd be burnt out.
The worst is, though, as you say, with some baseball games, they shoot them off. Have you noticed that a lot of ballparks shoot them off during the day with a home run? You're at a day game. And
there you go. Right.
They shoot them off. It's 1 o'clock in the afternoon. All we see are puffs of smoke.
Yeah. Well, you just think an airplane went down.
I would also
submit. We're being attacked.
I would submit that fireworks may straddle the rich man, poor man divide, which we've talked about. I was thinking this last night because, you know, like Brad Pitt paid $20,000 for a fireworks display when he got married to Jennifer Aniston. And if you've ever lived in a very poor neighborhood like I do right now in Koreatown, fireworks all the time.
Yes.
All the time.
And with impunity. We were out filming in like South Central and they don't light a black cat off and then sprint for the alley. They put on whole firework displays on the front lawn and they do it on the 2nd of July. They don't even wait for the 4th.
And the 10th.
Yes, rich man, poor man, fireworks. You know you arrived when you can hire a barge to be dragged out in front of your sea house and have a big fireworks show. But I will also say this. If you're throwing a party, that's the best $20,000 you're ever going to spend. Forget about the ice sculpture. Let's get this going.
That is nice. By the way, Brusca, why is it like the Nang in here? It's boiling. I'm getting a flashback to when I was in country. It's ridiculous.
I emailed Lynn. Lynn, if you're listening, I know I sent an email yesterday. I never got an email back.
Get Charlie Company in here to put on the AC.
The air conditioner didn't work yesterday. I was sweating like an animal.
Yeah. To be calm, don't feel it.
That's right.
And I didn't even get an email back. Lynn, please help us.
Thanks. All right. We will take ourselves a break.
What about Brusca's shirt, by the way?
You know what I like? That's not bad.
It's like a golf shirt, you know, the collared shirt like Tiger Woods at all, except it's got a zippy instead of the buttons.
I like the zippy.
It's not bad. It's one of those shirts that was meant to be seen in black and white. Old photos, you know, that kind of thing. There you go. That's 62. A snappy shirt. Yes. Yeah.
Just before I shipped off to...
It doesn't fit in here on the Ho Chi Minh Trail.
Yes, before... Dave got on his minesweep on his way to the Mekong Delta on his first tour. That's the shirt that was in style in that time period. All right. What do we got coming up today? What can't Adam complain about? That'll be delightful. Ann Coulter
can't
is
wait.
Calling in. I can't either. I know all of America hates her. I semi-agree with most of the stuff she comes out of her mouth. Also, Carlos Mencia... A very funny man, and Lisa Lampanelli, also a funny man, coming in. Now, I love Lisa Lampanelli and Carlos Mencia. You know why? Because A, they're funny, B, they put out. They show up and they work it. That's what I love about Lisa and Carlos. So they're coming in. Lisa, been on the show a few times, queen of the roast, I guess you might call her. News, sports, and much, much more after this.
It was called Yellow.
There's more coming up.
Hell yeah.
The Adam Carolla Show.
You're locked into the Adam Carolla Show on 97.1 KLSX Free FM.
Recently, Adam talked to Jan Chagnon, the mom who was hit in the head by her son when they fought about American Idol.
We have the young lady who was hit by her son... With a chain. Jan, he threw it at you or he swung it at you?
Neither, sir. He had it in his hand. He put his hand on top of my head.
No offense to you, ma'am, but if I put something in my hand and I rested it on top of your head, you'd probably not need stitches.
He went to wrestle my hair, sir, and he had it in his hand.
You're saying it's much ado about nothing because you went in there and they said, what happened? And you explained to them what happened, and that's how the news got started, right?
Yeah, because the name American Idol was mentioned.
You were pulling for Taylor Hicks.
Almost certainly.
Do you speak to everyone in that sort of sing-songy, condescending way? Make people you work with angry, you know. I do that to Bruska and Damashek every once in a while. I'd like you to get me some coffee because I enjoy a beverage.
So obviously they're passionate about music. So here they are to review a new CD on the Adam Carolla Show.
Yes. Talk about bookings, Jan and Corey. I labeled these two albino white trash. I know they can hear me, so I hope they don't take any offense to this. But I think when he whacked Mom in the head, it was with a keychain from some sort of biker memorabilia place. What was it?
I think it was Camelites.
Yeah. Oh, well, look, I got to tell you something, and maybe they're just going to hang up listening to this. But when I see the guy going down the street in the windbreaker he got because he cashed in the Marlboro Miles, or he's got the kayak because he smoked 700 cartons of Camels, it's always it's not a good sign. Cashing in things, collecting things, and then cashing them in is bad, whether it's blue chip stamps, whatever it is, even those cards you get stamped at the sub shop, you know, hey, your 10th one. I never go in for that because it means you're a loser. And you're admitting to the world a loser. It's the same thing that happens when you buy a lottery ticket. You're yelling, God, I'm a loser. God, I need this. When you're trying to save $2.99 every 10th sandwich, you're a tremendous loser. You think, oh, no, I'm thrifty. Oh, no, this just good economic sense. Oh, no. You're holding yourself down. I used to go to the Starbucks up the street, or maybe it was the Coffee Bean and Tea Leaf up the street from Kimmel's every single day. And every single day they said, you want to stamp the thing? And I'd say no. And they'd go, yeah, but you come in every day at the end of the week, you get a free whatever. And I'd go, no. And I'd pay for it. And then a guy next to me who went with me, one of the writers from Kimmel, would pull his thing out of the wallet and say, well, do mine. And I'd say no. I'm buying. You'll not do mine, and you'll not do his either.
I don't know why. See, yours is a principle thing. Mine is embarrassment. Like, I want to impress
both.
The guy at the coffee store, the guy who's working by the barista. Like, I don't want this guy to think I'm a loser.
No, yeah. It's both. But look, I'm telling you, for the same reason you shouldn't buy lottery tickets, because when you buy a lottery ticket, you're screaming at the gods. I'm a loser. I can't control my own destiny. And I need somebody to smile down upon me in order for me to get out of the asshole known as my life. Nobody should be buying a lottery ticket. It is the worst thing you can, it's the worst message you can send to yourself. For this same reason, nobody should get their sub ticket stamped. That's right. And I mean Subway. Corey?
Yes.
You're on the blower now. Corey, you're not living with your mom, Jan, anymore because of the courts?
Yes.
Okay.
That's correct.
And you had the keychain from where?
It was up here, we had a special going on with cigarettes. You buy two packs of Camels and you get a free West Coast chain bottle opener.
Perfect. All right.
Yeah.
Hold on a second. Definitely not at you. Let's get him down. Let's get Corey down for our Alcoa Presents. Definitely not at you coming up. Jan?
Yes.
All right. So, Jan, you were the recipient of the love tap your son Corey gave you with the promotional bottle opener, which then made you require some stitches in your scalp, right?
One stitch, sir.
One stitch. That shouldn't count. Yeah. All right. And now you guys can't live together because of the courts?
Yep, for right now.
For right now. When will you guys be reunited? Because me and my mom are looking to get back together, too. We just want to give it another 100 years.
Yeah. Probably the 13th.
The 13th. So you have that circled on your calendar with a heart?
Oh, yes. Most
so the state thinks it's unwise for these two to live together, but they're fighting for the right.
Mm-hmm.
That's it.
How old is Corey?
25.
Corey, 25.
Yes, sir.
Today is his birthday.
Oh, happy birthday.
Thank you, guys.
We should also review that part of the story, and correct me if I'm wrong, but Corey was on a combination of Vicodin, Klonopin, and vodka when this assault took place. Is that right?
Try to leave a cocktail like that.
Yeah.
Something like that.
So, Corey, you've had a run-in or two with the law?
Yeah.
And
you could say that.
And a little bit of substance abuse in your past, right?
Yes, sir.
And what really it seems like you need to do now that you're 25, here's the thing, everybody. Once you, when you leave the house at 11 or 12, it's important to come home again. when you leave at 25, don't need to come home except for Thanksgiving and Christmas. You know what I'm saying? Well, I'd like to get you guys in studio because Bruska barely cracks a smile when I do that joke. So
I'm a big fan of yours. I used to watch Manjo all the time.
Well, thanks.
I also heard Love Line, so I'm a big fan of yours.
Well, thanks, Corey.
See, look at the good.
I'm a fan not of you personally, but of your ilk.
I enjoy your
type of guy.
Dedicate the show to him and the millions like him.
I will dedicate today's show to you and the millions of Corys listening throughout the country. So, Corey, I'm interested in you staying sober and staying out of the house. How about that?
That's not a problem. That's not a problem.
How many days do you have put together?
For what?
Sobriety.
Oh, probably about 45 right now.
Wow, all right. That's good. Yeah. And are you getting checked up, you know, drug tests and that kind of thing from the court?
At this point, no. The court's not doing any drug tests or nothing like that. So,
what do you do, Corey? Are you able to work? Do you have a job?
Yeah, I work at a local pizza shop here in upstate New York.
All right, and are you able to? And don't sell thick crust, by the way. Just refuse to do it. I don't want you to get into it. Just say we're out of the thick crust when they.
Yeah, my dough's the best. So.
Okay, go nice and thin.
Yeah.
Are you able to support yourself? Will you be able to get a roommate, move out of the house, that?
I'm living with a roommate right now.
Oh, okay. Well, stay there then. Don't come back.
Yeah.
Okay. All right, so you guys are going to review a CD for us, correct?
Yes, sir.
You're both fans of the music, obviously, hence your love of American Idol. Dashboard Confessional, that's the new CD?
Right.
Yep. I don't know. What do? Hear the song and then you guys weigh in? We didn't get this far with it. All right, let's listen. Don't Wait, name of the song. I wish I could say I was hipper and into Dashboard Confessional. I know who they are, but I'm not hip enough to go home and listen to them.
Well, they're all one guy. I mean, they're band members, but it's all this Chris Caraba guy.
I feel sorry when they do the interview with the guy where it's like, yeah, he played the drums, the bass, the tambourine, the lead guitar, the whole thing. I feel sorry for the guys who then have to go out on tour with him because now you're sitting behind the drum kit. Obviously, you're not the guy we've been listening to on the radio.
That's better to me than being in Bon Jovi and not being Bon Jovi. Well, you're a part of making the music, but you have to be in this guy. It's his last name.
That's
what,
true.
Van Halen?
Yeah. Well, by the way, it's Jovi and Halen. It's not Bon Jovi and Van Halen. It's just Jovi.
I'm sorry. You're right.
So, Jan, why don't you chime in first? What do you think?
Sure. I really enjoyed the CD.
Mm-hmm.
I really, really did. If you really listen to the words, I kind of think that Chris Caraba went through some kind of lung cancer.
Really?
Yeah. If you listen to Don't Wait, it's got something in there about the knife cutting him too soon.
Uh-huh. Did he have some form of cancer?
I'm not sure. This is what I'm pulling from the CD.
So you figure he had lung cancer based on the song?
Yeah, especially the one, you know, Breeze.
Uh-huh, Breeze. Well, didn't Shania Twain or what's her name have it too? Faith Hill have lung cancer too?
The lungs don't fail me now. You know, I know you're strong enough to do this.
So you figure he's a cancer survivor?
Yeah. Definitely.
Okay. All right.
Smoking sucks. The air right out of your lungs.
I thought the wreck of the Edmund Fitzgerald was surviving testicular cancers. It turns out I read the lyrics. I was all wrong later on. It turned out to be about a barge that sunk on Lake Huron. But, you know what your mind can do sometimes.
You're not the first to make that mistake. You won't be the last.
Oh, no. Obviously, there are others. All right, Corey, what'd you think of it?
I personally enjoyed the CD, too. It's got sort of like a U2 meets Creed sound to it.
Mm-hmm.
My least
favorite band.
Yeah. And I mean the band knows how to put lyrics together.
Mm-hmm.
They got a lot of stuff going for them.
Mm-hmm.
But I think if you saw a lot more upbeat songs from them, they'd have a lot better success because all the songs on the CD were kind of slow.
Mm-hmm. Well, if just to work out a rating system, if four bashes in your mom's head with a tire chain would be the best an album could be.
How many
bashes in the head with a tire chain with Dashboard Confessional? How many would you give it, Corey?
Probably about a two.
Two bashes in your mom's head with a tire chain.
Yeah.
All right. Jan, how say you?
I'm going to say
how many stitches? You work in stitches. Four stitches being best.
I'm going to say three stitches.
Three stitches. So all right.
Three stitches.
So you guys are right. You're right. You know, middle to good.
Right.
All right. Well, we'll talk to you soon. We appreciate you being on the show. Burt Bacharach is coming out with a compilation CD, so we'll hit you back up in a couple of weeks.
Oh, good. Yeah.
Okay. And I'd also ask Corey to pay close attention to this between now and his next appearance. Corolla has this theory, this long-standing theory, that people don't really love pepperoni on their pizza.
Oh,
it's
interesting.
Just what everybody agrees to eat because it's the default because everybody will eat it, but nobody thinks it's their favorite. I say otherwise, of course. Like most normal people, pepperoni is perhaps the greatest topping.
Yeah.
So anyway, Corey, pay close attention to what the most popular topping is, if you don't mind.
Well, let's get into it for a second now. Here's my contention. My contention is when people grow up, I think there's a lot of things we do that are sort of based on a societal autopilot that no one ever really gets a pure polling for and figures out. For instance, trail mix. Everyone buys trail mix, not for their house, but if you're throwing a party, well, let's say if you're shopping for a crew, like when you work on a TV show or a movie, there's always big things of trail mix everywhere. Nobody really likes trail mix. It's just when they've exhausted the peanuts, when they've exhausted the smoked almonds, eventually they'll start digging into the trail mix and then people buy more trail mix. I don't think anyone likes trail mix. I say about pepperoni pizza, you grew up as a kid, they have kids parties. When they order pizza for kids parties, it's get five cheese and five pepperoni. That's just the way you do it. Who's going to argue? Everyone's 9 years old. Then you become an adult and there's an office party and they do the same thing. Get five cheese, five pepperoni. When, as it turns out, maybe you want the olive or maybe you want the sausage and onion or something like that. But we've carried over with this pepperoni thing. Nothing wrong with a pepperoni. I have no beef. Pardon the pun, with the pepperoni. I would rather have a sausage and onion than a pepperoni. Most of the people I know who've graduated into adulthood would rather have something than a pepperoni.
That's not so. You say that doesn't make it so. Most people you know would rather have something other than pepperoni. I don't think that's true.
He's saying pepperoni is like the Rugrats of pizza toppings. You outgrow it.
You outgrow it. I would say nobody's going to see, and no one would complain when you show up at a party and you go, what do we got here? Well, we got cheese and we got pepperoni. The guy goes, oh, I'll take a piece of pepperoni. But I would argue that that guy or that girl has a pizza they like better than the pepperoni.
Teresa,
it's the pepperoni will do.
Favorite topping.
Pineapple.
Oh, no.
I'm a vegetarian. I'm a vegetarian. You know what?
I call it pizza.
I'll tell you.
Bread and cheese.
Let me say this in honor of Corey. I wouldn't mind a pizza with Vicodin Clonopin.
I totally agree.
And a dose of Xanax.
I totally agree.
Hey, that would be a really good lunch.
Well, that's it. That's interesting. Now, so Corey.
Yes, sir.
What do you sell mostly? I'm guessing you sell. I'm not arguing that pepperoni isn't sold the most. I'm arguing that if people had the choice, they'd put it and check another box.
I mean, Garth Brooks has sold a lot too. Doesn't mean he's good.
That's right, Corey.
Yeah, I would have to say we sell, the old standby pepperoni the most.
Which one?
Pepperoni. I'd have to say we sell pepperoni.
Which
the
one
most.
Do you enjoy the most?
Myself, I enjoy bacon on my pizza. Gets a nice flavor.
Canadian bacon or the bacon?
No, the bacon.
Really?
Just proving your initial point, not a Jew.
Definitely not a Jew. Jan, what do you like on your pizza?
Oh, I got to go with the pineapple and ham.
Oh,
wow.
Oh, my God.
Thank you.
Pineapple and ham.
Thank you for your candor, both of you. It took brave people. I hate to admit this. I turned my nose up at the pineapple and ham, too, for many a year until it showed up at a few places I was at. It's the kind of thing where there's a few things I do that I'm not proud of. The pineapple and ham is one of them. It goes into other categories. But from a culinary standpoint, I don't like the way I don't like what I see in the mirror after I order a pineapple and ham. And I would never order pineapple and ham. But when it's at a party, I eat it.
Really?
I like it.
It's good.
Yeah.
You might like it. Pineapple on pizza might taste good with cheese. But just don't call it pizza. It's something else.
Well,
that's all. Give a new name to the food.
The now, the pineapple alone, I'm not so sure about, but maybe it's the Canadian bacon part of the pineapple and Canadian bacon that I'm responding to, but not bad. But again, thin crust. I think we can all at least agree on
Russ
that one.
Russ is waving at, either he's pointing at the clock or saying, let's get some pizza. I don't know what he's...
I'm saying, well, shut up, Damashek.
I'm chubby or I'm a lesbian.
He's saying Albano's opens in 18 minutes. You buy, I'll fly. All right, we'll take ourselves a little break. What can Am complain about? Ann Coulter calling in. Carlos Mencia in studio. Lisa Lampanelli in studio. What do we got coming up on the news or in the news, team?
Well, Rockstar Supernova premiered last night. Ooh. I'm going to play who I think is going to be the front runner. We'll see what you have to say. Also, Catherine McPhee. She lost American Idol. Now she's lost something else. I'll tell you about
she
that.
She got rid of that old boyfriend of hers.
And
I knew it.
A famous, famous actress is in rehab for something very strange.
Well, we look forward to those answers and many more after this.
You're listening to the new Adam Carolla Show.
This is Dave Attell. Give Adam a call now at 1-866-901-ADAM. And some flunky intern's going to pick up the phone and put you on hold. And you'll have to listen to probably Air Supply. It's worth it.
Coming up this morning on the Adam Carolla Show, comedian and host of Mind of Mencia, Carlos Mencia.
Do I look fat in this dress? No, you look fat in everything.
The woman railing against the 9/11 widows and the author of the bestseller Godless, Ann Coulter.
If they have a point to make about the 9/11 Commission, about how to fight the war on terrorism, how about sending in somebody we're allowed to respond to? No, no, no. We always have to respond to someone who just had a family member die.
And the reigning queen of mean, comedian Lisa Lampanelli.
Lady, have you ever done a black guy? It's worth the screwed up credit.
Give Adam a call at 866-901-ADAM. This is the Adam Carolla Show.
Yeah. I know, it sounds like a whole week's worth of show, but it's just in the next 3 hours. All right, we have some news, some sports coming up first. Let's take a phone call. Franz?
Yes, sir.
You have a manovation for me?
Yeah, I do. You know, you go to the bar and you need something, you don't have it. How about they market a product called a Drunkable? It's just like a Lunchable you give your kid.
Mm-hmm.
That's everything you need at the bar. You got a little Swisher Sweet cigar inside there. You got a pack of peanuts, little pickled knuckle.
So it's sort of like,
condom.
Yeah, when you go on the airplane, they give you that little thing that might have an eye mask and some some earplugs in it. This is for when you're going out boozing.
I like it. A pen and paper to take down numbers.
Yeah, right. You get a little nudie matchbook with a little number there for a gal's name on it. It folds up, and inside the package, you got a bar joke and a bar trick. Give you something to start conversation.
Mm-hmm. And you market this just toward children, or do you do it to adults as well?
Well, it's up to you. You know, what was that? You go for it. Good luck with that.
How big a loser do you have to be? How big a cop out is it as a parent when you start breaking down and getting the Lunchables? Here's some chemicalized cheese that doesn't really have any dairy in it, and some crackers that'll kill you if you eat more than four of them, and a stick to spread it on. Knock yourself out, Junior. Really? How about just 50 cents for the goddamn lunch truck when the kid's at school? You know what I mean? Like the processed meat, like the meat that doesn't need to be refrigerated, the cheese that doesn't need to be refrigerated, the stuff that has a shelf life of 400 years. How big a cop out? And at a certain point, to me, it's like powdered milk. Like, if you're whipping up powdered milk, don't have kids. If you can't afford a gallon of milk a week for the kiddies, do not break down and have the kids in the first place.
Yeah,
the powdered milk.
In fact, when you buy Lunchables, they report you to Child Protective Services.
That's how I would work it. That's how it would be a sting operation. I would have homing beacons on every Lunchables and everything of powdered milk. I grew up in a time when powdered milk was in vogue. By the way, there was a time when people thought, they thought powdered everything was a breakthrough. This is the Soylent Green years, I call them. This is when people thought we'll be eating dinner in a pill form in just 8 or 10 years. This every movie of the future was, what do you want, brisket? And the guy'd say, fine, and he'd hand him a pill that was brown. I'll take the turkey with all the trimmings. He'd get a white pill. Somehow, the geniuses that wrote these fictional novels decided that in the future, we'll not sit down and eat. We'll take a pill for everything. And then came the powdered form. Tang. I blame Tang and the space program for this. But we got powdered milk out of this whole deal. And I actually went to somebody's house. I remember at a kid's house where the mom, because evidently they were living high on the hog, would cut the powdered milk with the regular milk 50-50 cut. So he'd do, well, a gallon of regular milk and a gallon of powdered milk, which just made 2 gallons of ass water with a savings of almost 20 cents per 5 liters. It's like, what? How cheap do you have to be to punish yourself this way?
I can honestly say I don't think I've ever seen powdered milk. I don't even know what you're talking about.
Because your mother loved you.
Doesn't matter.
Ironically, it comes in a liquid form. No, it comes in a box. I think it was like Carnation or something made it. It comes in a box of powdered milk. Again, if your plane goes down in the desert, not a bad way to go. But if you live 20 feet from the Gelsons, do not punish yourself with powdered anything. Powdered is for when you're in the military and you're bivouacking.
Right.
Not when you're at home and you're whacking. You know what I'm saying. The more you know. All right. T.
Yes.
What's up, my dear, with the news?
North Korea has 3 or 4 more missiles on launch pads, according to media reports from South Korea, and they've promised more missile launches in the future. Mm. The missiles are either short or medium range this time, and the South Korean defense minister has warned further tests are indeed possible.
Mm.
President Bush commented on the situation yesterday.
They're still analyzing, trying to figure out the intention of the North Korean leader as to why he would have fired the rocket and what they were trying to learn from it. One thing we have learned is that the rocket didn't stay up very long and tumbled into the sea, which doesn't, frankly, diminish my desire to solve this problem.
Strategery.
Let me say this about the Koreans. Mean people. Tough people.
All
scary people. Yes, I learned that during the L.A. riots. You guys may not have been in town. I live
in Koreatown.
Well, now you do. Sure.
Yeah.
You're the mayor of Koreatown. But I was here during the riots. And it was a little freaky because I had to work. And the idea was you may get pulled over and pulled out of your car and they'll pull a Reginald Denny on you. Everyone was heading for the hills, not the Koreans. They headed for the roof of the liquor store. They got the 30-06 and they kept the Schwarz away. They're tough people that way. I remember thinking, wow, these guys are badasses. You know, everyone else was getting rounded up and getting into cop cars and heading for high ground, not the Koreans. They hit the roof. They got the bolt action Winchester out, and they went to work on anyone that went near their liquor stores, which I sort of appreciated. But I realized an entire nation of those people would be a tough place to live.
Well, President Bush not happy with Kim Jong-il.
And when are we just going to kill people? I mean, when are we just... Well... You know, every movie has these sort of hit teams. You know how we're famous for taking out people? Everything's a conspiracy. Oh, we took out the Kennedys. Oh, we'll take this guy out. Oh, we took that guy. We never take anybody out. How about an international hit team? There's a troublemaker, Kim Jong-il. Go take him out. Just put a bullet in his head.
Or Bin Laden.
Yes, just
go.
Yes, don't take the country out. Take the man out. Just put a bullet in that Just for Men riddled head of his and just put him in the ground.
Instead this our resident kook leader sounds essentially like he's saying bring it on. Is really the tone of voice. His missile didn't go very far.
I agree. There was a mocking tone. Although what people don't remember.
He couldn't do it. He couldn't do what he wanted. Bring it on.
I'm George W. Bush and I approve this message.
It tumbled into the B. Sir, that's C. Oh, the C.
I knew it was a letter. In the 50s, when we were trying out our missiles, we also had similar trouble. So we should remember that, and then we fixed it.
Right.
It also should be noted that Kim Jong-il looks a little bit like a chubby lesbian.
Yeah, a little bit. Bruska and him are taking a me day on Saturday.
And they're both a little bit dictatorial at times.
Just put a bullet
in his head.
I'm
chubby or a lesbian.
He's nuts. I do, on the other hand, think that a lot of these guys, these nut job dictators, if they think you're scared, no matter what you have in your arsenal, they'll take that as weakness and they'll just plow forward.
Well,
I do like the idea that we flex a little muscle every once in a while.
I do as well.
Sorry.
No problem. Let's move on to another injustice. This one in the world of entertainment. The Emmy nominations came out just this morning. The Sopranos, which perennially leads the nominations, received 1 nomination in a major category, that for Best Drama. Snubbed James Gandolfini and Edie Falco.
Wow. Really?
Yeah. One nomination.
Are we just over them? Do we not like him going into his dream sequence? Are we starting to believe that they're just actually those people and therefore it's almost a documentary and they deserve no credit for acting? I think that may be what it is.
Grey's Anatomy had 11 nominations, 24 led with 12. Do you want to hear the nominations?
Sure.
Okay. Drama or comedy?
Because I know they do them at 4:15 in the morning.
So exactly.
Everyone always answers with, "Well, that's so the East Coast." Yeah, screw the East Coast. Let them get it at noon.
By the way, the East Coast, it's not such urgent news that the East Coast know who's nominated for an Emmy before they go to work on
right before
Thursday
Wall
morning.
Street. Before the bell sounds on Wall Street, we need to just let them hear it at noon. Do you think guys who live in Albany would be all right with hearing about what went on in as far as the Emmys go by noon? Have him do it at noon. We'll start at 9.
Let's hear
Thank
drama.
You. The more you know.
The nominations in the drama series category are Grey's Anatomy, House, The Sopranos, 24, and The West Wing.
Mm-hmm.
House is my favorite show on television except The Sopranos.
I hear it's good. 24 I tried getting into, and I don't know. It feels like a parody of one of those shows a little bit, you know, like Jack Bauer, you know, that thing. And he's trapped in an airport. No one knows he's there. And he's got to drop in through the heating system and stuff. Doesn't it feel like, is it too much?
I'm ashamed to say I haven't seen 24.
I tried to watch.
I've seen 10 minutes of one of them.
I can't follow it. Let's hear the comedies.
Wow.
The nominations in the comedy series category are Arrested Development, Curb Your Enthusiasm, The Office, Scrubs, and 2 and a Half Men.
2 and a Half Men.
Yeah, I don't...
I hate to say this about my beloved Kerr, but has it jumped the shark a little bit? Has Larry David become aware of himself, being aware of himself?
I think it's still better than any of the competition.
A little bit, but, well, that's true, but it seems like he is now doing himself when he does the show. He used to do these things. He had these idiosyncratic behaviors that seemed sort of natural. Now he sort of seems aware of it. It's almost like it's funny when the 5-year-old comes into the living room and makes a joke for all the parents. And then when the kid turns around and comes back and preloads one, all of a sudden it's not so funny anymore because it's too plotting. It's too conceived, too well thought out. I kind of feel that way about Curb. I hate people that call it Curb, by the way, but I feel that way about people that call it Curb. I feel like it's become aware of itself a little bit and is getting into itself a little too much.
Well, if they even do another season, there's peaks and valleys. Same with Seinfeld. Don't forget, Seinfeld had a down season or two.
Absolutely. Last night was the premiere of Rockstar Supernova. Mark Burnett was in studio yesterday and promised us a high level of talent. I believe that the show delivered. Now, here was my favorite, the 4:11 powerhouse, Jill Joya, singing a Joplin classic.
I caught the last 10 seconds of that and then went right into Satisfaction. Sorry, I'm losing my voice. But I had to turn it off when it went into Satisfaction because I've had an ass full of the Stones and I've had an ass full of Satisfaction, a mediocre rock song at best. Stones officially more bad songs than good songs and need to be punished. Thank you.
Speaking of people who have lost their voice, Catherine McPhee. Lost Idol. Now she's lost her voice. She was absent last night when the Idol tour kicked off in New Hampshire. The doctors ordered total voice rest. So, no, she hasn't lost the boyfriend, as you predicted, but I think that's probably forthcoming.
If I were him, I would be in double down, I'm going to lose this chick sex mode.
How does that go?
It's a move I go into when it's clear that the end is near.
Oh, my God. Wait.
That's sort of what it sounds like. And, basically, here's what it is. You've checked the clock of the relationship. You know you have between 3 and 7 weeks, and you want to get in all the living before the S house comes down. That's it. Because what you don't want to do is 5 years from then been walking around thinking, could have nailed her one more time.
So if you see the end is near.
it's basically the equivalent of you ripping off stuff from the workplace because you know you're going to get S-canned in a couple of weeks. Time to start bringing home copier toner because I may not be coming back on Monday.
Little by little, there's a stapler in the pocket, some Post-its in the purse.
Yes, and then it moves into lighting fixtures, desks. I took a T-bar ceiling out of my old office. This whole ceiling is shoved down my pants.
Okay, I'm going to make this quick because Breska's giving me the stink eye.
Yes.
Ashley Judd went into a 47-day rehab treatment, not for alcohol or drugs, but for depression, isolation, and codependent relationships. This according to a portion of the interview obtained by USA that she gave to Glamour magazine. According to Judd, I was unhappy, and now I'm happy.
I've heard she's crazy.
Well, she had isolation, depression, and codependent.
She's a minx, though, I'll say that.
Yeah. Also, does she have the same dad as Winona?
Yes. Yes. They're sisters.
Wow. Now I'm worried. So I got the twins.
One of them
could be a wildebeest.
No, but your wife is naturally thin, and I think that's genetic.
Yeah, but what the hell happened there? A nature or nurture? How is one a beautiful pixie and the other just a Jabba the Hutt?
Well, I'll tell you what Winona told Oprah, and I'm not ashamed to say that I know this a little bit. She said that Winona said that she had a problem. She was addicted to food. She was an emotional eater, and so she gained a lot of weight.
Yeah, but there's more going on than 60 pounds there. The whole body, the whole bones are different. It's like one came out the vagina and the other came out the nostril. Something's going on. Something's kooky there. All I'm saying is same dad, same mom. Same egg, same sperm.
Yeah, genetic recombination. It's a funny thing.
But they're all nutty. That's the important part.
That they have in common.
All right.
And it's our Commander-in-Chief's birthday. Bush turns 60 today. I'm Teresa Strasser, and that's the news.
It's time for Dave Damashek's number one sports. Number one sports. Do it, Dave.
How about them Halos? Southern California Angels have won 5 straight.
Uh-oh, they must be getting near 500.
Still 4 down. Still 4 to go till they're up.
No, they'll be 500 at the All-Star break.
Well, they swept the Seattles yesterday. Mm-hmm. They finished it. Believe it or not, as crummy as they've been all season long, they're now just 4 back in the AL West behind the Oakland Athletics, who lost to the mighty Tigers.
Yeah.
So it's interesting. Bartolo Colon, the Cy Young winner last year in the American League, pitched a complete game shutout. Maybe the Halos can get back into
it. Well, they have 86 or 7 short games before they're out.
Right.
I mean, the season will be over in just another about 90 games or so. So it's time really to step it up.
Yes.
Really need to step it up. Almost 100 games to go.
They're about 80 to go. All right.
About 80 to go. Let's really pick it up, fellas.
Senior
80 more games.
Dodger blew past the Snakes of Arizona.
Hold on. I'm just saying this. If you're one of the Angels batters, you're only going to get up another 350 or 400 times. So it's really time to start making contact.
Christ.
You know what I mean? You got to focus.
Hater of our national pastime. I will continue. San Diego Papas abused the Phillies. The Creep and his gigantic pals dropped one on the Colorado Balboas. I changed it from Rockies to Balboas.
That's nice.
Thank you. Beautiful game. Football. The finals are set. Zinedine Zidane, a.k.a. Zizou.
Zizou.
Scored on a penalty kick and France beat Portugal 1-0. So the finals are set. On Sunday, it's France and Italia for the World Cup. And on Saturday, the third place game between Portugal and the Nazis.
Yes, the Nazis.
And lastly, because Brusca's holding, I got a lot to talk about. We'll talk about it next with Jose Canseco. He played one game for the minor leagues and insisted on being traded so he could be closer to L.A. where his daughter lives. And we got to talk about that. Barry Bonds, you know, the guy who's standing up for him, Greg Anderson, refused to testify yesterday in front of the grand jury. So essentially that means that he has the poop on Barry Bonds and doesn't want to give him up.
He's in jail now, right?
But what's exciting, yes, he's back to jail. He's been sent off to jail. But I want to talk about, did you hear who USC just got the biggest recruit since LeBron James? A guy named O.J. Mayo.
Mayo.
O.J. Mayo has said, he verbally has committed, apparently, to USC. Another O.J. at USC. It went so well the first time. Let's bring him back.
Is he football or basketball?
He's a basketball player.
Okay.
Another OJ
right.
in the garnet and gold. And it's time to say hello again to OJ. You say S, I say C. You say dunk, and I say shoot a three.
What's going on?
And I say mayo, OJ mayo. I don't know why you say OJ. I say mayo. Not enough.
I gotta, Dave. I don't want to rain on your parade, but I was driving in this morning listening to Man Cow, and he did the exact same song, almost. I mean, line for line.
Really?
Yeah. So come on, buddy. Yeah, don't go. Don't, you know, if you go, if you think of it, there's a good chance someone else thought of it and beat you to it. Yeah, yeah.
That's it.
All right, sorry.
Dave Damashek's number one sports.
You didn't hear it on the ride in. You just came up with that. The song.
What? Yeah. That was my. I didn't steal that.
All right. It just sounded almost exactly as the OJ Mayo Welcome to USC song that I heard on Man Cow.
I'm not saying I did steal it. I'm not saying I didn't. I just.
Mm-hmm. All right. Okay. All right. Okay, listen, I don't want to put you on the spot. You don't have to re-sing
Mayo,
it.
Mayo.
It's a coincidence. Things happen.
You say shoot.
All right, Ann Coulter going to be calling in. Also, Carlos Mencia coming in. Lisa Lampanelli coming in as well. And we'll play a spirited round of What Can't Adam Complain About after this. So call in, tell us, and look, stretch me a little bit.
By the way, 1-866-901-ADAM.
It's good of you. Very professional. 866-901-ADAM's the number you call, and we'll play a round of What Can't Adam Complain About after this.
The Adam Carolla Show. If you're going to wake up with a strange, hairy man, it might as well be him.
Jeff Probst is here from Survivor.
It's Ask Kiss Rodeo.
Love your hat, Adam, by the way. It's a great hat.
I love sushi.
Sushi is maybe the best meal out there, unless there's something I haven't tried.
I hate sushi.
And then there are times when sushi goes through you and you think, why'd I just eat it?
I've heard enough. Where's the new celebrity belt?
Stick around. Headed your way, more on the Adam Carolla Show.
What can Adam complain about? As it turns out, I can complain about anything.
I wanted to see if you could complain about the cure for polio.
There used to be that one kid that had the short leg and had to wear the shoe with the extended heel on it. Now everyone is tall and everything works. Everyone's cured. And what do we got? One more a-hole in front of me at a red light who doesn't know it's legal to turn right.
I say you can't possibly complain about the movie Goodfellas.
I can. I'll tell you why. I run into people who tell you, oh, yeah, their movie Bob's. Oh, they love Bobby De Niro. And then you go, well, Goodfellas must be. Oh, no, never seen. And you're like, what? And then you want to sell a lesser movie to, have you seen The Neverending Story? Yes, I saw The Neverending Story. Well, that's right. Don't change the subject. If you have not seen Goodfellas at least 4.5 times, don't even talk to me.
Give Adam a call at 866-901-ADAM. This is the Adam Carolla Show.
Well, yes, it is. Still coming up on the Adam Carolla Show, Ann Coulter, also Carlos Mencia, Lisa Lampanelli. I love that Lisa Lampanelli. I like Mencia, too, but she's a sweetheart. Big bundle of love. And actually, getting smaller every day. We'll see how her weight's doing. She was big when I saw her at the roast.
But also, has a devilish wit.
Yeah, she's mean, and she loves the blacks. That's why I love her. All right, this little something. Oh.
Stuff.
Here we go.
The world is full of it, and one man has a complaint for it all. This is What Can't Adam Complain About?
You call in, you throw topics, I complain about them. I start at the top with line one, and I make my way down to the bottom.
The world's greatest
line
complainer
eight.
And by
on
the
display.
Way, he has no idea what he's going to be complaining about.
That's right. That's what keeps me fresh. You know, let me explain something. I'm like a good center fielder when it comes to complaining. I don't start running forward before I hear the sound of the ball hitting the bat. I stay in my neutral zone, ready to go back to the fence and climb the wall if need be, ready to come sliding forward on my belly and pull one off the grass if need be. If you start running backwards, then a Texas leaguer will drop in front of you, and if you start sprinting forward, someone's going to hit a rope over your head. I have to stay in that position. That's what can't Adam complain about is about. Mike.
Yo.
How say you? Let's get started.
I say that you can't complain about getting beat up yesterday, man, while you were filming your movie.
Were you there?
I was there.
I want people to see I showed Dave during the bathroom break when I was performing, or I mean when we were going number one together, my hip. Everyone in this studio, please look at the side of the Ace Man's hip over here.
Huge bruise.
Yes.
I
look like a battered wife. It was horrible.
Do you have to say that you ran into the corner? No one hit you?
No. I was beaten severely for about 4 hours yesterday.
Over and over again.
Over and over and over again. And people say, well, you choreograph it. It's a boxing thing. I would say this. I would rather go down the street and be hit in the head with a 2x4 than have it planned out and know when it was going to happen and have to endure it over and over again. I actually say to the people that are beating me up who are scared they're beating me up,
right,
please beat me up so it looks good so we can move on. I'd rather be hit in the head once hard, get it, and move on than hitting the head 126 times at half speed. That's where the brain damage comes in.
Wait, caller, how was Adam?
Hey, Adam was great. He was a little irritated. Oscar couldn't say yob to save his life.
Oswaldo's in this movie, all right? Oswaldo. Oswaldo's the corner man in the movie. There's a line where my trainer says, jab, 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 and he says, yeah, yob, yob, yob. Although he says jab like Tony Randall would say jab.
He
like,
says jab perfect.
Sir John Gielgud would say jab. And all of a sudden, he speaks the Queen's English. And it's like, Ozzy, Ozzy. And I'm trying to get him to mispronounce a word for once in my life. Meanwhile, the guy hasn't been able to pronounce my name for 16 years. He calls me, ow, ow. Sounds like a dog taking a bite out of something is when he's yelling my name. But he says jab like this, job. He says, I said, no, yob, jab. Ozzy, just say yob, jab. Ozzy, God damn it, say yob, jab. Says it exactly fine. So the irony is he can't pronounce anything until you ask him to mispronounce one word, and then he says it perfectly. And after about the 28th time, and here's the beauty of Ozzy, you just go back and forth. Like, say yob to me 10 times, just so yob and I'll answer. This is what it sounds like with Ozzy.
Yob.
Jab.
Yob.
Jab.
Yab.
Jab.
Yab.
Jab.
Yab.
Jab.
Yab.
Jab.
Yab.
And then about the 26th time, it's like, would you say something different? At least yell the N-word out. Please. Please.
He explained it to me sitting in the front row. And I was sitting there. I was like, you know, I really think Adam just wants you to say yab instead of jab. And he's all, oh, yeah, well, you know, the Y and the J pronounced the same. He went into the whole Spanish dictionary. And he's all, so I keep saying jab. And I was like, yeah, man, I don't think he wants the J.
All I'm saying to everybody is about the 25th time somebody tries to get you to do something different than you did the other 24 times, try something new. Don't say it exactly the same. That's Ozzy. Cannot mispronounce the word jab. Cannot say yob.
But he can't talk English.
All right. I'm sorry. Thank you, Mike.
Yeah,
I'm just. I'm still fired up about yesterday. I gotta be honest with you. Who's up next? Another Mike. Mike, how say you?
Yes. How you doing this morning, Adam?
I was doing well before he reminded me of the yob, jab, Ozzy flashback. I almost had a meltdown yesterday. Go ahead.
Well, like you, I'm literally a millionaire.
Oh, really?
Yes, I am.
Wow.
Literally. Hmm. Quite literally.
Mm-hmm.
I am just asking you not to talk about your bidet, and your analogies are very clear. Mm-hmm. And whenever you talk about an analogy of cleaning peanut butter from a shag rug,
mm-hmm,
makes me hurl like David Alan Greer.
Mm. All right. That rhymed.
There's
a lot more commentary
stuff
than we normally need.
Do you want Adam to complain about something? I'm confused.
What's that?
Are you trying to get Adam to complain about something?
It's his bidet.
My bidet. How can I complain about my bidet? All right. I'll complain about my bidet. I went to a hotel in New York, the Riga Royal, about 5 years ago. I sat down on the toilet seat and I saw a button. And because I'm cut out of a certain kind of cloth, I was man enough to push the button while sitting in the prone position on the toilet and felt a warm, gentle squirt of hot water in the tukai. It was delightful, and we immediately fell in love. I said, where do you get these toilet seats? Kimmel found me one, got me one, and this is why Jimmy is the greatest friend in the world. You come home raving about a clean a-hole, and a few weeks later, a device that gives you a clean a-hole shows up on your doorstep. I ask you, what more could you ask for? And you hook the thing up, and it squirts in the ass. It feels great. Here's the problem. It sends a very dangerous slash confusing message to people that visit your house. They come into the bathroom. You're like, hey, go ahead and use the bathroom upstairs. Then they come out of the bathroom with a puzzled look on their face because they've seen a device that's flesh-colored with hoses and wires coming from it. And they go, tactfully, did your grandma used to stay with you? You know, whenever they query about a grandparent living at the house, it's never a good thing. It means something in the ass. I don't know what it is. When you get older, everything's going in a hole. You're either spoon-fed something or there's a jet of water going up you. But everything has to do with bags and bottles and enemas and streams of water shooting in there. So it doesn't send a sexy message to the ladies especially, but I'll tell you, it is effective. Nothing better, and you'll not want to do without once you've experienced a warm jet in the ass.
He uses a bidet to clean his bum, and he pees in a sink.
Well, you want to talk about range? You want to talk about Renaissance Man? Forget about a guy who boxes and writes poetry. How about a guy that whizzes in the sink but then uses the bidet?
Sweet.
And I will say that the bidet is so excellent that it almost stumped you. But you're still able to complain about it.
Yeah. All right. Let's talk to Alfonso here. Alfonso, how say you, my friend?
I'm doing a TPI swap in a 1979 El Camino right now.
Mm-hmm.
I'm not a millionaire.
Mm-hmm. a TPI.
Yeah, that's a tuned torque fuel injection, 1992 Camaro IROC.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yes.
The most beautiful racing machine on earth.
Mm-hmm.
Beard in 1940,
mm-hmm.
World War II.
Yeah.
P-51 Mustang.
How do I complain about the airplane that was easy on the eyes but tough on access tanks, huh? The one, this is the greatest plane ever. I'll get to complaining in a second. First off, P-51 Mustang came out at the end of World War II. Beautiful stainless steel aluminum machine with the big. Yeah. Now, it used to have an Allison 12-cylinder engine, and we swapped it out for the Merlin Marine Rolls-Royce engine with the supercharger on it. The thing made like 3,000 horsepower and flew like 525 miles an hour. Imagine.
That'd
be like fire. Oh, imagine the day. This is back before we had all the computers and the military had to answer to people. There's great footage. After the war was all but won, they would just send guys out. Here's the deal. Escort the bombers over Berlin, bomb the Nazis, as Dave would say, and then on the way back, go ahead and shoot at targets of opportunity. You have nobody looking over your shoulder. You're flying alone in an aircraft that flies 50 miles an hour faster than any other aircraft ever conceived. You have 20 millimeter cannon and 44 caliber machine guns, and you're loaded for bear. Your job is to fly over Europe, strafe the countryside, and if you see a farmhouse, or you see a train, or you see a guy looking suspicious pushing a wagon, open up. Just open up 40 feet above the ground. Just open up. There's a rail car. Open up. And then do a barrel roll, turn back around, and come back in again. And nobody's going to ask you where you've been or how much you've shot your guns. What a time. What a time. That's why those guys are all the greatest guys in the world. Now, Mustang P-51, greatest plane ever made. Thing that pisses me off about it now is they destroyed them after the war. With just like any other war, we had thousands of them. They're no good to us anymore. Now we're in the jet age, so we tear them all apart. We leave a few. Who has them? Tom Cruise. Tom Cruise has one. It's worth $10 million. You could have bought one in 1947 for $5,000. Now it's $50 million, and only the Cruiser has one. And he flies one on 2020 when he's got Diane Sawyer in the back, and it makes me want to vomit. That's what I have to say about the P-51 Mustang.
Well done.
All right. I'm now tired. I'm sweating profusely. Still angry about Ozzy not being able to mispronounce Yob.
It's a dirty Yob.
Thanks.
That was What Can't Adam Complain About?
All right. And controversial Ann Coulter next on the Adam Carolla Show.
This is the Adam Carolla Show.
Kimmel and Sarah came over, of course, right when Lynette is crying. Lynette is overwhelmed. The kids are crying. Lynette's been running around. She's feeling out of it. She just breaks down in a heap of tears on the sofa. I'm sort of looking at her. Kimmel looks at her and then looks at me, and Sarah looks at me like, you pig. Really?
Don't ever, 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 ever miss the show. The Adam Carolla Show.
If people are going to use a personal tragedy in their lives to inject themselves into a national debate, I'm sorry, you can't just say, oh, we're off limits. Oh, now we're going to invoke the fact that our husbands died and you can't criticize us. They were specifically using their husband's death, and there were, gosh,
that doesn't
hundreds,
mean they're enjoying
fact,
it. I mean, presumably they're going home at night
widows.
And their husband's gone and their yes. kids are there and where's dad? And it's, geez, it's so depressing.
And so are the thousands of widows who are not cutting campaign commercials for Clinton. These women got paid. They ought to take their money and shut up about it.
Give Adam a call.
Wow.
866-901-ADAM. This is the Adam Carolla Show.
I do like this Stone song. I know I was getting into them a few moments ago, but I do like this song. Ann Coulter is due to call in. Very controversial, Ann Coulter. We don't agree on everything, and I agree that she's not very popular amongst liberals and Democrats, as Democrats and Republicans as well, probably because of the way she goes at things. But we do agree in principle on certain things, which is there's tragedies, whether it's 9/11, whether it's Oklahoma, whether it's kids dying abroad or in car accidents, and society has sort of turned into a society where we interview the grieving and they say, what are we supposed to do now? I had a husband that made money. Now he's gone. What am I supposed to do? And I have sort of the same answer for them, as tough as it sounds, to the people that say, hey, welfare, I'm only getting $639 a month. What am I supposed to do? How am I supposed to live off that? How am I supposed to support my children? I have three kids. How's $600? You're not. You're supposed to work. That's how it goes. You go to work. That's what you have to do. Now, we have to help out people every once in a while when a flood blows through their town. But in general, if you're married and you have a couple of kids, you got to get some life insurance. That's the way it works. And everyone says, well, we can't afford, we can't afford, we can't afford. Well, it's your job to work to afford that. And if S happens, as it often does, there is no guarantees. You can get rear-ended and put into a wheelchair, and the guy could have no insurance. And what are you supposed to do? You better have your ducks in line in case it happens. And I think until you're willing to do that, you shouldn't be crapping out the kids. Or maybe you shouldn't be getting married. I think that's the difference, maybe fundamentally. Maybe this is what makes me a Republican, even though I don't claim to be. The deal is if you want to live with a few buddies in an apartment and do your own thing, then do your own thing. But if you want to crap out a few kids, put people into the system, in other words, which are your children, then you have to put things into play that will protect them potentially, not only against you passing, but against whatever horrible tragedies may befall your family. I'm filibustering here because Ann Coulter's still not called in. I think she may be on line 8. Is that her, Brusket? No. Didn't she burn us twice? Because I'm not going to be nice to her if this is the second time she's burned us.
Did I hear a phone ring?
Yeah.
No.
She was supposed to come in here a few weeks back. I saw her on the Tonight Show. And then she was supposed to call in today. And I'm going to give her about another 30 seconds before... I dig
it. You want to go back to pizza toppings?
Hold on. Yes. To your point, if I may.
Yes.
It is frustrating when people have babies that they then can't pay for. A woman like Ann Coulter does not believe in freedom of choice.
Mm-hmm.
So.
Yes.
It's a bit of a conundrum.
Well, this is.
Sweet irony.
Thank you.
This is the problem I have with Democrats and Republicans, which is, as far as the Republicans go, Chuck Heston and his buddies, I'm all about all the freedoms they talk about constantly, but then these are the same guys who want your house taken by the government if you grow a pot plant. So on one hand, you can have all the guns you want And until you go into a liquor store and start shooting the place up, you're free to carry a gun in your truck. You're free to carry one on your person. You're free to spread them all over the house or hide them all over the yard like goddamn Easter eggs. But you grow one goddamn pot plant, and the government should come in with black ops helicopters and confiscate your house and put it up on auction,
I think,
on the auction block.
Right. Chuck Heston and company are for their personal freedoms.
Right.
They're not for a woman who has who's with child.
Yes.
They're not for that sort of freedom to choose what you want to do with.
It is amazing that they just talk about freedom, 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 and then the second a guy grows, there's a freedom that isn't on their menu, that's not on their dry erase board of specials out in front of their crappy restaurant, then they want the hippie locked up and burned at the stake.
Freedom a la carte.
Yes. I really don't understand it. Like, my feeling is, and one day, when I get enough FU money, and that day is coming soon, I'm going to grow a huge pot plant in my yard, and then I'm going to the Supreme Court with it, because I really can't figure out why you can't do that. Mm-hmm. And if you had enough FU money, if you could afford enough attorneys, why you couldn't just keep fighting that one on your property. You're not selling it. No one's ever saw you sell it. No one's even seen you smoke it. You're just growing a pot plant. All right. Anyway, Ozzy's on the phone, changing gears
same
for
thing.
A second here.
Well,
because
he couldn't get Coulter, so we got
Ozzy. They're both controversial. Ozzy and I have been working on this movie together, and there's a line in the script where instead of saying the word jab, he says yab, which is perfect for Ozzy because he can't pronounce my name. So all he has to do is pronounce jab the way all his folks would say jab, which is yab, but he can't do it. I love that about Ozzy. Ozzy?
Hi, good morning, Alan.
Good morning. I'm just going to start mispronouncing your name. Cheryl. I know you thought I was going to go Ozzy, but I'm just going a completely different direction. Ozzy?
Yes, sir?
The word... Now here's the part. I can say jab and I can say yab. They're just two different words to me.
Yeah.
Why can't you parrot back what I say?
Yeah, I say yab.
That was good?
It was close. Say it again.
Yab.
No, that was jab.
Yab.
That was yab. Now, okay, here's the problem. You get jab or you get yop.
Yes.
It ends with a P. Can't say yob.
Yab.
Ooh.
That was perfect.
All right, now say... So
yop.
He had to say it three times. That was the problem. He had to say yob, 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 and he would say jab, yop, yop.
Can you
yop,
do can
yop,
you do three?
Yop.
Yeah.
No, he said jab.
Can you do three
yop,
in a row?
Yob, yob,
yob. Ozzy.
Yes?
Here's what I'm saying. What you're saying sounds a little bit like yob, but it's sort of between jab and yob. Why not just say yob? Hold on a second. Let's go around the room. Can you say jab?
Jab.
And can
yep,
you say
yep.
All right, well, hold on a second. All right, let me shake my mind like an Etch-a-Sketch. I'm a blank slate, Ozzy. Now say it three times.
Yap, yap, yap.
Now he said jab, but he started with jab.
Yeah. Two for three.
Right, so now picture me, I'm on my 12th hour of being awake, and I'm covered in fake sweat and headgear, and I have a mouthpiece in, and I'm yelling at Ozzy, just say yob! And he says jab. Yob! Jab. Yob! Jab. Then you try to pick a word that he thinks he's pronouncing correctly, but it's going to sound like yob. Like, say, Ozzy, how would you say job?
You know, the problem is, you know, the teacher system in United States for learn English to the people, Spanish people, you know, use the Y for the pronunciation, the J.
It's
almost close.
All right, hold on. Everyone always tells you the origins of their problem. Like, you're like, my God, buddy, you never have a penny on you. Yeah, you know, I choose not to work. Oh, okay. Oh, I didn't know. I'm sorry, Judge. I didn't know. I know there's a reason. I'm asking you to change. I'm asking you to get a job, is what I'm saying. You know, when everyone has to explain what happened? Geez, the movie started 10 minutes ago. Where were you? Yeah, I know. I was late. Where's my scratch pad? I gotta get this stuff down. Yes. I know you guys do the J instead of the Y, or the Y instead of the J. I'm asking you to do it my way once. That's all.
Just repeat after me. I don't care. Let's go back to the other way when we're done here.
Yes, when I look, if I could read the word unique and read and it would sound like Unique, and then someone would tap me on the shoulder and go, I know it kind of looks like Unique. We pronounce it unique. And I'd go, oh, okay. That's what I'll... That's the thing. That's what I'm asking, Ozzy. I know what the origins of the problem are. It was you being born in Nicaragua 47 years ago. But I'm asking you to say yab.
Yab, yab, yab.
Still sort of yap.
No, well, that's what he's saying to you. Yap, yap, yap.
Oh, I see.
That's all you do.
Just keep talking.
Can I ask Ozzy, because I know the movie's called The Hammer, and I know it's about boxing, but Ozzy, can you give me more information about the movie that Adam is in?
The movie is over, you know, the life together, Adam and me, several times.
Adam.
Adam. Several times, you know. He helped me, you know, for bringing my mama to United States.
Mm. Oh.
You know, in my country, it's a political problem, the war, you know, no...
I didn't realize
working.
The movie focused
falling
so
closely
on Ozzy.
It doesn't.
It's about the Nicaraguan war.
It's nothing to do with the Sandinistas. And then.
Yeah, Sandinistas.
It's a buddy picture about you and Ozzy.
Yeah. Here's... We had a nice experience the other day, too, where Ozzy was supposed to be arguing with his mama from Nicaragua, who's apparently just a woman from Nicaragua, not an actress. So we... About the 11th take after he was told 25 times, look, you guys need to have an argument, not a quiet discussion. I started screaming at both of them to just goddamn start arguing. Everyone looked at me like like a horrible racist. But you started arguing, didn't you, Ozzy?
Yeah. You tried to pushing my mama for say something, you know. My mama no good. It's the same, you know.
All right, Ozzy, I'll see you later. Here's my point. Hey, here's all I'm saying. Please tell me if I'm wrong, because I feel like society thinks I'm out of line when I do this. I say to somebody, or somebody says to somebody, here's what we need you to do. And the person goes, all right, and they don't do it. And then they say, stop. And then they say very nicely, maybe you didn't understand, here's what we need you to do. And then they don't do it again. And then someone says, hold the camera, stop the roll. Here's what we need you to do. And about the eighth time, I step in and go, hey, you're wasting everyone's goddamn time. Now just effing do what we told you to do and let's go. And then everyone looks at me like, whoa, where did that come from? Well, let me tell you where it came from. It came from me standing here for 20 minutes watching you ignore whatever was asked of you. And somewhere around the eighth time you ignored, I stepped in and started yelling at you. Why am I yelling? Because you forced my hand. You would not do it the first 10 times you were asked. Now everyone's like, oh, where does he get that? Well, I would ask you, in terms of inconveniencing those around you, what's worse, me yelling at you or you making 25 people stand around while we watch you ignore the advice of whoever advised you, be it a director or a supervisor, whether it's Brusca telling Big Tad what to do or whether it's me telling a Nicaraguan farm woman how to act? What takes up more time? Who's being more inconvenient? Your feelings are being hurt, but we're wasting thousands of dollars here. What happened to the society where you could yell at people? It doesn't go on anymore. It used to go on in the workplace where about the third time you F something up, your boss would call you in and he'd throw a name at you.
I understand it works very well for child rearing.
Really? Okay, good.
What is going on?
Good. Noted. Noted. All right. Mike August, the world's greatest booker from within the building. Like I said, he's our talent booker. He booked Ozzy. He got Ozzy on short notice.
Where's Coulter?
I don't know. And the fact, what Ozzy's publicist was doing up at this early hour, again, a tip of the hat to Mike August being able to pull those strings at this hour. Mike?
Yes, sir.
Ann Coulter was supposed to be on this show 3 weeks ago, 4 weeks ago, when she was out here doing the Tonight Show.
That is correct.
Then she was supposed to call in this morning.
That is also correct.
Where is she?
I have no idea. Her people are insisting, insisting that she's dialing us, even at this very moment.
I think this, when August fails to produce someone he promises, he should have to do an impression of that person. And he should now have to be Ann Coulter and answer questions as her. And it better be a very effective impression, too.
One might argue that he exudes more sexuality.
Really? You think Ann Coulter's asexual?
I think it's a very bad sign when you're thin and you're blonde and you have a nice body and I don't want to F you.
It does seem troubling.
That's the most damning thing I could say about somebody. When you look pretty good in a cocktail dress and you have long blonde hair and you have blue eyes and there's nothing wrong with you and yet no man in the country wants to climb on top of you, that's a bad sign. That what that's like is a restaurant with a nice sign but a bad smell coming from the smokestack.
So she's dialing Mike August as we speak?
Seriously dialing. Seriously dialing, I'm told.
Yeah. How many Mississippis in between numbers? Is that how she dials? Listen, Mike, you failed once again miserably.
I feel just terrible about this.
Right. Now, we'll not be seeing you until after the show because none of the cyber sex chicks will be in. Mike's policy is when the cyber sex chicks come in here and get nude, he's in here at 8 a.m. Until then, he shows up at 10:15.
Well, that has to be supervised.
Yes, Mike. All right. Well, we're disappointed in you.
I am disappointed in myself.
Okay, well, as long as you beat yourself up.
He's going to beat himself, that's for sure.
You know, a lot of people go through life saying, don't beat yourself up. I go the other way. You should really be kicking your own ass just a little bit more. Really.
You just hate yourself a little bit.
Hate yourself a little more, Mike, and we'll move on to a commercial break.
And Ann Coulter has no culpability in this at all.
Well, I don't like the part of life where, you know, the dog jumps the fence and we blame the owner, not the dog. She's the dog in this case, and we should be blaming her. But the problem is it's sort of like when we got into trouble with the folks for Dave Damashek's off-colored racial remarks. I had to take the blame. Yes, thank you. I had to take the blame. Why? Because I'm the platoon leader,
right.
and one of my jarheads got out of line and shot up the village.
Does this mean I have to go to Ann Coulter sensitivity training?
Yes, it does. Oh, all right, buddy. We'll see you in 2 hours and 11 minutes.
Yes, you shall.
All right. And I would ask that when you come in, you be horribly distracted, and whatever conversation we're having, you be on the conversation before it. All right?
All right.
That's what's nice. It's really like a museum of conversation. Between Brusca and August in here, you get to hear the last four conversations you are having because they're still having them.
It's like time travel.
It's great. The Museum of Boring Conversations. We'll take ourselves a break. We'll be right back. Carlos Mencia. God bless his Mexican heart. He's in studio.
Do you think he's with Ann Coulter? Or he's here?
He's here.
Oh, good.
I saw him walk in. All right, we'll talk to Carlos Mencia right after this.
Sadly, this will be the best part of your day. The Adam Carolla Show.
Fast food is one thing that has not gone up in price at all. Everything was $1 when I was a kid, and gas was 75 cents, and now it remains $1, and gas is $4.
Hey, everyone's entitled to Adam's opinion. The Adam Carolla Show.
Guys, I hate to break it to you, but if a girl is sending porno emails to 40 million guys, she's not a virgin. And she's probably not a girl either. What did they tell you in high school? Get good grades. Go to college. What did you say? I don't need to do that. Well, guess what, pendejo? Ding! Fries ready. Do you know who drives our tanks? Black people. Now, what is a tank really but a sophisticated machine that does what? Drive-bys!
Give Adam a call at 866-901-ADAM. This is the Adam Carolla Show.
Carlos Mencia in studio. Good to see you, Carlos.
What's up, buddy?
My name is Mencia. Second season, been passing billboards now with the 40-foot-tall Carlos Mencia. Head's the same size, but the body, 40. We just found out via Dave.
Huge head.
Dave Damashek that he is in the lot where we used to do the man show and in our former office.
You two share an office. You were in it at one point, Carolla.
Jimmy and I spent many a season breaking wind in that office.
With the bald guy, was he there? Daddy Arbuckle just running around?
Yeah. Yeah, up in
on a bike.
Yeah, there's a bald guy.
Oh, God, I know that guy.
There's a bald... For some reason, It's not okay to ride a beach cruiser after the age of 17, except for if you work on a lot, in which case you get to be in your 80s and ride around a beach cruiser. But while you're wearing Dockers and a button-down collar, and he always drives around.
And a tie sometimes. And a tie.
Yeah, I think his name's Pat. Is that Pat?
Yes, his name is Pat.
Yes, it is.
Although I knew him as old guy on the beach cruiser. But, yeah, would always drive around the lot and make sure all the light bulbs were working. So you're up in our office.
Yes.
And do you have a partner? Are you in there with more than one person?
In my office? No, I got my own office.
Oh, sweet.
I got that big office on the second floor.
That must be nice for you because you are from a huge family, probably had to share a room most of your life.
18 kids. There's 18 kids.
For real?
For real.
There's
18 kids in my family.
He's not kidding you.
Now, do you tell me how you feel about this? Like, I sort of feel like being an only child is, I wouldn't call it abuse, but it's not a great childhood to grow up without a sibling.
It's abusive.
But after 9 or
it's
10,
abusive.
It's abuse,
I'm gonna tell you,
right?
No, after 9 or 10, it's awesome because nobody bothers you
anymore.
Can
you name all of your siblings?
No, I can't. Because I'm going to miss one. That's why it always happens, dude. That's exactly what always happens. Or I put them in the wrong order or something.
Doc. Yeah.
You know what I mean?
I mean, you know them as give me, get me, lend me, and take me, right?
Yeah, exactly.
Because they're all poor and they all want your money.
Yeah, but they're cool. I mean, you know, but I get, you know what the best one is? I got a sister who has her kids call me. She's the best because, like, her kids will call me and go, Uncle Carlos, can I get some shoes? And can you give me a check for $356.48? Dude, put your mom on the phone. What are you doing? What are you doing telling your kids? Well, that's what they... Nobody asks for... No kids ask for cents. I'm paying some bill. Just tell me who to write the check to. It's fine.
Now, you're from Honduras, right?
Yeah, I was born in Honduras.
Your mom is from Mexico, though.
My mom's from Mexico.
And who's still back in Honduras, or is everybody over here, and is this
No,
one?
There's a couple that were like, they came here, and they didn't like it, and they
really?
Went back. Yeah, too much. They said, you work too hard here.
I like that.
They said, nah, I don't want to work that hard.
So they went back to Honduras.
Yeah, because over there, they, you know, you plant your corn, which is really hard work, you know what I mean? You got to chop everything down, burn it up, plant it.
Right.
And then it's like, all right, 3 months off, you know what I mean? And that's it. And then you go back and, you know, here and there, pick up jobs. So, but here, it's, dude, you got to get up at, you know, especially if you're illegal, you got to get up here 5 o'clock in the morning and go to sleep at, you know, 9, 10 o'clock at night.
I know it's the, you know, they sort of look at this as the land of opportunity, but it's a serious, the opportunity to be a slave to white guys, basically, is what it is.
I mean, it's a good life
for the people you're working for, but your life does suck. And boy, I'm not into Honduras now. I'm into Mexico. How much must it suck?
From Mexico, too. So.
Right. So is mom and dad, or is everyone alive?
Yeah, pretty much.
Pretty much
everybody.
And everyone's out here except for a handful of people that are...
Except for the holdouts. And those people, oh, God, do they ask for money.
Seriously, give me the names of your siblings chronological order.
No, we'll not do that.
If you leave out one, they'll call in.
No, that's not what happens. You know what happens when I leave out one? I get a phone call from my mom, and then all of a sudden I get a phone call from my sister. Remember when you were little and you broke your arm? Who took you to the hospital? I can't believe it. And then it's going to cost me like $5,000.
What about this?
That's exactly what happens.
If you leave out a sibling, you will pay them $350.48.
All right, here's
what number are you, by the way? I'm gonna because I'm
17.
Oh, you're number 17 out of 18.
Yeah,
you're the baby.
All right, let me see. It's Heriberto, Manuel, Joaquin, Marta, Ana, Gosel, Rosa, Toti, Jenny. I'm sorry, Dorca. Yes, I have a
Dorca.
Sister named Dorca.
That's a retarded whale.
You're up to 11.
Yeah, I know. That's Dorca. Let me see. Maribel, Dices, Olga. What am I at right now?
14.
Then there's me, 15.
Oh, you're 15.
Right? Two more.
I thought you were 17.
Then there's Juan. I'm not number 15, but I'm saying not. Yeah.
Oh, okay.
Juan, Jose,
Herschel.
I think it's Herschel.
Juan and Jose, and I'm missing one, right?
I think you got 17. I think you did.
No, but there's 18 of us.
Oh,
I'm missing one.
Seth.
I'm missing one.
Did you just throw in Jose?
Christina. Oh, Christina, my God. Thank God I got Christina or that one. That one would have cost me $5,000.
Oh.
Yeah, wow. I got a daughter. I got a sister named Dorka.
Wow.
And she used to sell Amway.
Oh, really?
So she used to, like, call people up and, I'm selling blah, blah, blah. And my name's Dorka. And they'd laugh and hang up. Stop cream calling. And she was like, that's my name.
Dorka Mencia sounds like an SNL character that they're making fun of your show.
Right.
Oh, my God. Natural birth, by the way. They all...
All natural, no C-sections, no doctors. When I was born, I was actually born by myself with my mom, just me and my mom.
Your mom's vagina must be the size of a land arch.
Yeah, well, I'm not saying...
Yes, when you go down to Monument Valley and you see the natural land bridge that was created over millions of years.
So. Yeah. For the last 3 months I was in there, I was holding on.
I was holding on.
It was like a slip and slide by the time I got there, dude. Why are my feet so cold?
How old was your mother when she had the first kid? And how
14.
Old?
14.
And then how old when the
44, 45, something like that.
Wow. That's and are your parents still married?
Yeah. And I said to my dad when I was like 16, I go, Dad, why'd you guys have so many kids? Was it because there's no Social Security in the countries that we come from? And he was like, what? Oh. I swear to God, that's exactly what he said.
How about going down to the drugstore and getting some birth control?
Well, are you Catholic? Care.
Come on, what kind of question
what
is that?
What kind of question is that?
Maybe it was a religious thing.
No, the Beaner
Scientologists.
Hello, yeah,
they're
exactly.
Orthodox Jews.
Mijo,
wow.
We are the Jewish people. You must honor Yom Kippur.
Some people are more religious than other people.
What are you doing walking around? He's Rosh Hashanah. Come on, everybody.
Oh, Carlos, answer this, though.
The Sparks are subject. Taking our jobs.
Well, you do speak Yiddish. I'll forgive you for shaming me.
It's okay. What's the poop with you and George Lopez? You had a fist fight?
With George?
Yeah.
Yeah, that's the report.
Listen, this is how sad and pathetic some people's lives are. What was it? About 13 years ago, I went up to the comedy club, to which one? Laugh Factory. Mm-hmm. To say to George, dude, there's no reason you gotta be talking smack. There's no reason we gotta fight, dude. There's like 5 Beaners doing comedy at the time, and you and I are one of them. Why would we fight? You know what I mean? What's the problem with that? Yeah. And, he grabbed me by the shirt, and then his wife was there. And I said, do you want to do this here? And he stepped off, and I walked away. And that
and
was
13
it.
13 years
That's
ago?
That's the fight.
That was 13 years
That's
ago?
I swear to God, 13 years ago. And I was dating a stripper named Sherry who used to work at Cheetah's at the time.
Wait a second.
Hey, brother. Sherry, stage 5. She's dating a Mexican guy. Honduras.
Savannah.
Buddy.
Savannah. Her name was Savannah.
Savannah stage. Jade, stage 1. Jade. Ah!
Do that voice, though. Hi, everybody, give it up for Savannah. Put a tip on that sexy hip.
Savannah, straight from heaven by way of Menominee, Wisconsin. Hey, welcome to stage.
Give it up for sexy Savannah.
Now,
give it up for Portia. Anybody want to guess if she's black? Portia.
Hop inside that Porsche, take for drag.
Give it up for Jaguar. Anybody want to guess if she's black? Jaguar. Blackstrippers always have the car names.
Can we animate? I mean, can we just take that and just put it on a loop? Do we really need a fat guy with a fanny pack and a bad coat?
So you were dating. But that was 13 years ago. And wow. So it's like, but here's what happened.
Yes.
And I was kind of an ass at the time. I was young. But I was doing a Taco Bell joke, which, by the way, if you speak Spanish and you go to Taco Bell and there's a product called Chilito.
Mm-hmm.
Which in translation means little penis.
Right.
And you're a comedian.
Right.
That's comedy 101.
Sure.
You cannot claim that joke. You cannot be the only Beaner that saw
the Chilito joke.
Little penis joke.
So George Lopez accused you of stealing that joke.
Yeah. And I, instead of saying, you know, you've been doing it longer, I'll stop, I was like, F you, dude. Who are you to tell me what I can and cannot do?
F you, Chilito.
So.
Bill Maher.
That's how this whole thing started.
Bill Maher and I got into the same thing over the Bell Beefer many years ago. I don't want to get into it.
Over the Nachos Bel Grande?
Yes.
Yeah. And then, and then Joe Rogan walks around telling everybody that I say I'm Mexican. And I was like, dude, everybody knows I'm from Honduras. That's the whole thing. He says he's Mexican. I never say I'm Mexican.
Now, I couldn't help noticing that when you were talking about George Lopez and his wife, you did a thing with your hand where you said his wife. Like that. Yeah. What did you mean?
Oh, because she was talking.
She was encouraging.
But
the
I don't want to like talk bad about his wife because that wasn't it. It's just that she was like really mad at me at the time when that happened. So that's why I was like, she was going, yeah, you know, you stole his material and all that kind of stuff. And I was like, ooh.
Hey. We have Steven on line one who says he's your cousin-in-law.
Steve is my cousin-in-law?
Steve?
Do you know him?
You say you're Carlos's cousin-in-law. And by the way, when you have 18 siblings, how do you even get to that?
Are you married to Dorca?
Not yet. Hey.
Not yet?
No, yeah. I like to order a chilito with small fries.
That's it?
A little penis and small fries. So they had that. They have the Mexi Melt. That's a joke that writes itself. They had an enchirito.
Yes.
Which is an enchilada and a burrito. So that joke writes itself.
Yeah. You want to know a joke that writes itself? I put in an application at the North Hollywood Taco Bell when I was 16 and was rejected. I'm still in therapy over that.
On what grounds?
They don't tell you why you're not Taco Bell material, but I did find out I was not Taco Bell material when I was 16.
Really?
Yeah. As if my shame spiral couldn't have gone any deeper. Now, rejected from Taco Bell.
You speak English too well. By the way, what happened to you with, what's his name, happened with my brother. My brother Joseph, he's on the show, and he's the local. He's been here for 35 years, but he can't speak English worth
crap. Oh, Ozzy, yeah.
So we had him playing the president in the future. We had this skit where he's playing the president in the future where he's supposed to say, everybody must acculturate in this country and learn to speak English properly. Mm-hmm. Right?
Right.
Which, by the way, when we tell him, say job, he says yob. That's, you know what I'm saying?
Yes.
We go, hey, say what's up? What's up? You know what I mean?
Right.
All of a sudden, we tell him, hey, say in the United States of America, in the future, you must acculturate. And we're like, we're all ready for the laugh. We're like, this is going to be great. In the United States of America, you must acculturate and learn to speak English properly. What happened to the accent, dude? What are you doing? No, you got to screw this up. Mess this up. In the United States of America, what is wrong with you?
It's amazing that when you want them to F up and butcher the language, I ask Ozzy not to butcher the language 364 days out of the year. The one day I ask him to butcher a word, he'll not do it, which just means to me he's being aggressive now. Not even passive aggressive.
Aggressive.
That's an
aggressive
attack.
He's attacking you?
That's nothing short of an attack. All right, we need to take a break. Carlos Mencia is here. I love the fact that he's a sister named Dorca. We will take ourselves a quick break. We'll be back with him. Also, Lisa Lampanelli coming up. All that after this.
It's my job to tell you that you're listening to The Adam Carolla Show. That was easy. It's The Adam Carolla Show. Hey, let's check Adam's voicemail on The Adam Carolla Show.
Adam Carolla. Message. I want to go to the radio and talk to Chuck Norris. What are you talking about? Adam Carolla. I called in the other day and Big Tag gave me the runaround because I had some jerk that I wanted to nominate for the jerk report and he wouldn't let me.
Here's Adam. This is the Adam Carolla Show.
Yeah, when Big Tad is giving you the runaround, it's officially time to kill yourself, if that's what your life has come
to.
Can
he run?
Yeah. He could give you the waddle around, but he cannot give you the runaround. Carlos Mencia in studio, Mind of Mencia. New episodes start on Sunday night, 10 o'clock, on Comedy Central. The little show that could. Started out. And I know how Comedy Central works. They have a sort of wait and see approach to see if things work out. Not a lot of billboards, not a lot of commercials, not a lot of money. Let's see what goes on. let's see if this guy turns into the Honduras John Stewart. And after a season and some success, now they're your biggest fans.
Here's a dollar.
I see the billboard.
Go to a show.
As I drive to work, I see the commercials now. It has captured the attention and the imagination of our nation.
Hi, I'm Ann Coulter, and I'm a raving bitch.
Thank you.
I will not call Adam Carolla.
I don't care. She didn't call in, what do you think of Ann Coulter?
I think she's psycho, man. She's crazy. She's crazy.
Do you think she's crazy like a fox, like I'm laughing all the way to the bank?
Of course she is. Well, she's lucky that people think she's hot. Because no way in hell would an ugly bitch get away with any of that stuff.
Yeah, but I argue, even though technically hot, nobody wants to have sex with her.
Doesn't matter. Pleasing, a lot of people see her as pleasing to the eye, so they have her on.
Mm.
Ugly chick, never get away with that. You would never have Rosie O'Donnell.
Yeah. If she...
saying all that stuff. And people going, Rosie O'Donnell here. Yeah, they never do that. You know what I mean? If it was some feminist chick with,
it's true.
Hairy armpits.
You know what it's like? It's like smoking a cigar. When a hot chick is smoking a cigar, it's like, whoa, look at that.
Right.
Look at her over there. That's exactly. A turtle. When a fat jack, hey, you want to put that out, fatty?
Yeah, exactly.
Don't you haul your fat ass out on the porch and smoke that stogie? Come on, I'm going to vomit over here.
We're in a cigar shop. I don't care, fat ass. Get out. You're ruining my Cuban, you fat whore. Get out.
But I'm your daughter. We run this business together.
I don't care. Get out.
But ever since mom died and you brought me into the small business.
Where's the bag you're supposed to have on your face, fatty?
But daddy, you're going on vacation
next
week.
I'm not your father. I told you. You don't care.
That's true. When you're hot, you get to say what you want. It becomes provocative. When you're fat, you say what you want. You're just a loudmouth bitch.
Exactly. That's why it sucks that dodgeball doesn't exist anymore. Because dodgeball is when hot chicks realized they were going to get good grades. You didn't get hit hard in dodgeball, did you?
I took a few hits.
Really?
Yeah.
Did you really?
Yeah. I used to be chubby.
Late bloomer. Because hot chicks underhanded.
Yeah, here you go, baby.
Ugly chicks, man.
I'll roll it at you. There you go.
Exactly.
Just don't hate me.
Fat chicks right now are having flashbacks.
Well, also, it's hard to miss the fat chicks with the utility ball. They present quite a sizable target. Also,
even the skinny chicks with the glasses. Remember when you used to try to hit them on the top of the head so their head would go back so fast that the glasses would actually do that matrix thing and just kind of float for a few seconds? There's nothing bad. That's when I was like, double points, dude. Double points. Glasses off.
That's what I learned from my entire, first grade to sixth grade experience. I pretty much just walked away with, well, I guess the object in life is to hit people with balls. That's really like if I was an alien and I came down to study our culture and I just hung out in the fourth grade at a public school, I would go back to my planet and say, these people are obsessed with throwing balls at each other. And I imagine whoever's the best at throwing a ball will eventually lead the nation. Well, if you hit a guy with a utility ball hard enough, you'll go on to great things.
But it teaches like American competitiveness. I mean, in the end, that's what it's all about. It's like people that say, those illegal aliens are taking our jobs. Let's get one thing straight. If some guy that just got here from Nicaragua applies for a job, and so do you, you went to school in this country and you grew up in this country and he actually gets the job, how bad was your interview?
Yeah. You're really
bad.
You do have to take a swing at a guy's nutsack in order to screw that one up.
Let's pretend that you're the boss and interview me and I just got here from Nicaragua.
All right, I'll call you Ozzy's last name because he's Nicaraguan. His last name is Castillo. Mr. Castillo, what makes you think you're qualified to work here at Norco Corporation? Mr. Castillo?
Castillo, si. Castillo.
What makes you feel like you're Norco material?
Narco, no.
No, I mean, that's the name of the company we work for. Work for Norco Corporation. What makes you feel like you'd be a good fit here at the company?
Pues, Brasil. Football. Es el mejor, pero perdieron, y ahora Italia.
Do you know word perfect? Yeah, I know, and imagine.
Hey, perfect. Esa sí la sé, perfect. El ice cream, perfect.
No,
es muy bueno el pastel.
I don't want a hot dog wrapped in bacon. I'm sorry, we're going to have to put that out, by the
How
way.
How do you lose your job to that guy?
I want to hear the interview. Thank you. I want to hear the interview of the guy that didn't get the job. Okay, go ahead.
All I got to do is bring Big Tad in here.
Just ask me any question. I'll do the other guy.
He sings Dead or Alive. All right, I'll call you Mr. Newcomb. That's sure. Tad's last okay. name. Mr. Newcomb, what makes you think you're a Norco
peanut
material?
Butter makes me horny. Peanut butter makes me horny. I love peanut butter. Peanut butter makes me horny.
Mr.
Lick
Newcomb.
It, peanut butter, lick it. Lick the peanut butter, lick it.
Mr. Newcomb, we have a half hour for lunch and a 10-minute break.
I love peanut butter every half hour. Because I lick it.
10-minute break every 2 hours.
The crunch guy with peanuts.
The employee crunch refrigerator is cleaned out every Friday, by the way, if you leave anything.
Put it in
behind.
The refrigerator because it's peanut butter, or it gets very bad. Peanut butter with peanuts.
Yes.
But not too crunchy, because when you rub it on your body, it gets really sprinkly and it hurts.
I think I agree in that I would rather hire a guy who didn't speak the language rather than a super stupid guy who did speak the language and wanted to talk.
Right.
Yes.
I think that's the direction we head. We go. Might as well just hire one of Carlos's 27 brothers or sisters. That way, as long as we don't establish eye contact, we never have to talk.
Exactly.
As opposed to Big Tad, who wants to chill on the weekend.
Right.
Smart.
But then there's the other guys, of course, Adam. The guys that have been here, like my brother, for 30 years. Because I know this guy. He actually works at the Mickey D's between 3rd Street and 6th Street off of Vermont.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I live right near there.
He gets pissed all the time. Every time I talk to him, I don't understand why they never give me the promotion.
But then when you go, I'm serious, go to that drive-thru at 2 o'clock in the morning. He's the overnight guy.
Mm-hmm.
This is what you hear. Welcome to Madonna's.
Wait, what's his first name? What's his first name? I want to say hello.
I'm not going to say it. Welcome to Madonna has a restaurant.
Madonna's? This
That's what he
great.
Said. Madonna's? And then he gets mad. I go, Madonna's? No, I didn't say Madonna. I said Madonna. It's like the same with a pause. Shut up, dude. How long have you been here? 30 years.
Carlos Mencia in studio. Mind of Mencia. We need to take a break, Carlos.
Yeah.
God bless you. Thanks for coming in.
I don't want you to leave. You insinuated that I was so hot that people wouldn't hit me with their dodgeballs. I love you now.
Yeah. Yeah, I know. It is weird that you train, essentially kids train to hit kids with balls for the first 12 years of their lives as if they're going to use this skill somewhere in the future, and then you never do. Or if you do pick up a ball and hit somebody with it as an adult, you now have a lawsuit on your hands.
Well, I hate to go out on a down note, but George Lopez's wife just called and said, peanut butter makes me horny.
Carlos Mencia, Mind of Mencia, second big season, new episodes start Sunday night, 10 o'clock, Comedy Central. Lisa Lampanelli coming up. Also, much, much more news, sports. Kim Jong-il, I think, will be calling in as well. Question mark. Bruska made a face.
We couldn't get Coulter, but we might be able to get Kim Jong-il.
We will.
Oh, you can get Kim Jong-il. Don't worry about it.
We will see.
Call.
It might be you.
Carlos, good luck, and thank you, my friend.
Thank you, my friend.
We'll be back after this.
Thanks, Carlos. It's Sarah Silverman, and you're listening to The Adam Carolla Show. Why don't you do something proactive with your life? Why don't you call in 866-901-ADAM instead of just sitting there listening in your stupid car? I hate you.
Awesome. The Adam Carolla Show. Here's what not to watch on TV tonight. 5 p.m. on Discovery Home Channel. Garden Police. A makeshift putting green has ruined a front yard. 6 p.m. on Showtime. A love song for Bobby Long. A jaded teen forms an unlikely bond with a former literature professor. 9 p.m. on the Hallmark Channel. Desolation Canyon. Starring Patrick Duffy and Stacey Keach. That's what not to watch. Now back to the Adam Carolla Show.
Sure, we could tell you what's on, what to watch, what to look for, but again, what to avoid.
Just as helpful, if not more so.
Well, it's like when you travel to another country. You know, stay away from the water. Make sure you can get shut. Do not go to this part of town. Better that than try this restaurant. I can discover that on my own.
Avoid that Patrick Duffy movie.
Yeah, that idea started when I saw Daughter of McLeod advertised in the TV Guide, and I thought, well, I hated the first McCloud in 1974. Now, I assume I will hate his daughter solving crime as well. All right. Now, where were we? Where are we? Lisa Lampanelli, one of my favorites, coming in a moment. News and sports on the way. I had a question. I want to talk about a couple things. First is spiders.
Yes.
If you know anything about spiders, I suggest you give us a call at 866-901-ADAM. I want to know how these creatures work, how to get rid of them, and what to do about them, because they're all over my goddamn house. I find one on the ceiling almost every night over my bed before I go to bed, and I used to transport the spider outside. I used to put the cup over the thing, then I would slide the envelope, then I would carry the thing out, toss it out the door, and I'd go back in. Now, I realized all it would do was hump another spider, knock her up, and then come back in, and they'd give birth inside of my dwelling. I decided at a certain point to just start smashing all insects. I don't care what happens to my karma. I'm tired of the spiders on my ceiling. And why throwing them out just gets them back in. They're not. I think there's a thing where we think bugs are confused when they're inside our house. I think they know what they're doing. What do you want? You want to go outside?
Climate-controlled food?
Yes. Would you rather be outside being chased by a lizard or inside with the Ace Man biting his arm and watching TiVo?
I think spiders lay eggs. So
yes.
Even if you kill them, they may have already laid eggs in your home.
They seem to be, there doesn't seem to be anything you can do about getting rid of them. They just seem to keep coming and coming. Other insects, like roaches and ants, you come in and you sort of eradicate them. You let the fogger off, whatever it is, and they seem to be gone. Spiders seem to keep coming, and they don't get, you know, there's a lot of this stuff. A lot of people trying to defend the spiders. Like, hey, you know, the spiders eat the bad bugs. I bought into this line of crap for 25 years. So they eat the bad bugs. Really? Just once, I'd like to show up into my kitchen, flip the light on, and see a spider kicking the ass out of a roach or beating the crap out of a silverfish. It doesn't seem to happen. I just see him on the ceiling over my bed, ready to land on me and attempt to eat me in my sleep. I never see them kicking a flea's ass, kicking around a roach. I never see it. I don't even see anything in their webs other than junk that blew off a tree or the occasional moth, which I don't seem to mind. Mm-hmm. A moth to me, it's like a small bird that doesn't make any noise or crap on anything. Spiders, I have a problem with. And then you have people come in with the spider bites and they're allergic to. We brought the kids home. The very first day the twins came home, I was upstairs. I heard my wife screaming from the den. By the way, you women, you need a variable speed on your screaming, not just on and off. My wife has no screaming or screaming. Could mean raped by gangbangers in the living room or lost an earring. It's the same scream.
Yes, I have two speeds.
From upstairs, it's always the worst. And Maniac has escaped the insane asylum. He's jumped the fence, and he's now holding a broken bottle under my wife's throat in the living room when, in fact, she broke a nail. Go ahead and have a 1 through 10 in the scream department so I know how to respond. But she starts screaming. I run downstairs. There's a huge black spider that's in the bassinet of the kids. And we don't now slid by one of the folds and everything. My point is do we really need these things? Do they ever beat up the bad bugs? And let's start killing them. And then how do we get rid of them? Now, you go to the store, and they always have the spray, the poison, the traps. It's always the same thing. It's like ants, roaches, and spiders. It's always and. Mm-hmm. What's the one that's for spiders? You know, I don't want the one that works great on the ants, works pretty good on the roaches, and it's kind of come see, come saw with the spiders. I want something that's made for spiders. The other thing I want, and nobody can figure this out, although every time I open a Sky Mall on a long trip, there's that thing, oh, you plant this in your lawn, and it shows the drawing of the ultrasonic sound waves and rodents and spiders and roaches hauling ass into the neighbor's yard. They can't get away from this ultrasound fast enough when, in fact, you break down and buy one, you see it planting in the yard, and it's actually being effed by a roach. What works? What can I use?
This is a good question. I know when I was little, and I love all animals. I'm a vegetarian. But when I saw a spider, I would pay my brother 50 cents per spider, or if it was big, to kill the spider with a broomstick.
Now, you can, yeah, you can spray the poison around, but what does that do?
Nothing.
And how do you trap it, and how do you eradicate it? And what about the equivalent of the roach motel for the spider or the ant trap for the spider? The thing that's nice about those is you take a few of those baited traps, you spread them around the house, you put them on the counter, you put them under the sink, and the things get into it and take it back
to
the nest.
By definition, they can't stick to stuff, right? So they could just roll over like a roach motel. They can't get stuck.
But
they can traverse the web, whereas their prey cannot.
That's another good point, which is the web. Spider webs everywhere, especially during the summer.
How about at night when you walk out the door? You ever get hit by one in the face?
Oh, it's the worst.
And you start flailing around like a retarded maniac, throwing punches and karate kicks into the air.
Yeah.
Meanwhile, the neighbor's like, the Corolla boy's gone insane again. I saw him trying to punch a tree branch. Like, there's that one. Yes. During the summer, somehow the spiders can get, and I think it's during the wind. I think it's when the wind blows them, they can start at the top of the tree, go sailing down. The wind blows them all the way across the driveway to the other tree. The span is 35 feet long, and of course you don't see it at night. You just know when you're walking up the driveway with a handful of crap and you feel this thing in your face, and then you start flailing uncontrollably so you look insane. But also,
thinking about it, I'm getting creeped out.
I had spider webs in my car the other day. They're all over. Like, if you have a house and you just let it go for 6 months, they'll be all over the window eaves and all under the eaves of the house and under the windows and all that stuff. And what is a web, by the way? Spider web, it's silk. I think it's somewhere across between a loogie and
BM.
Somewhere. No, I think it may be worse.
Well,
I think it's.
Where does it come from?
I don't care if it comes from France. It's gross, but it comes out the ass.
That's what I'm saying.
It doesn't come out the ass.
It seems to, the thorax.
All I'm saying is I am walking into a face full of spider ass and seed and semen and dookie. Whatever, it's in your face, it's in your hair.
And we're supposed to let them live because the claim is that they're eating all the other...
Well, they are predators.
I agree that I don't see them. I don't see the ladybug in the web. I don't see the bee in the web.
I'll tell you, all it would take for me is you killing one good roach a year, and you would forever be off of my hit list.
They just have good PR. That's what they have. It's like Carl Rose running their campaign for the spider. Nothing bad can happen to him.
All right, so I'm going to try to figure this out. Let me go through the phones here. Taryn?
Hey, Adam.
What's happening, Taryn?
I have some stuff I bought at a local grocery store that starts with an R.
Mm-hmm.
And it's called Hot Shot, and it works great because I hate spiders.
Yeah, but you have to spray it onto them or around, and then it smells like poison in the house, right?
No, it's not that bad. I just spray it around like the floor, like the baseboard. And if I see a spider, and the spiders know when my husband's home, Adam.
They do.
They absolutely know, and they make me kill them, and I flush them down the toilet.
Taryn, does everyone you meet call you Karen the first time?
Well, I am Karen. Your caller guy called me Karen.
Sounds like you have mental problems, man.
Tad, I thought you would have to die to be dumber than you are now. But it turns out there's one more level of stupidity.
He does like peanut butter.
You've now reached. All right.
Tad giving you the big finger. What do you call that move when you take the one arm and you slap your forearm with the hand, you know, like it's the big sort of Sieg Heil kind of
you've FU? You've supersized your FU. You've Dane cooked it. All right. I know you can spray poison on a spider, but I don't want to spray poison. I want to leave out something that gets them or that convinces them not to come into my goddamn bedroom. Now, then there's this part, too, where you're supposed to get a bigger thing that you don't want in your house. Well, you know what you do? You get a bobcat. Natural enemy. The badger is the natural enemy of the spider. So they'll eat. Gecko, lizard, or you get yourself a hyena.
Think about an elephant seal.
Black mamba.
You get a bull walrus. It's like, yeah, I know. Then I have something else that's bigger that's eating. Where does it end? But now that's horrible advice. I don't like that. Get another pest to run around your house that scares your wife even more to get rid of the smaller pests. That's not an argument. Step on them, I have. Let me talk to Eric. He's from Phoenix. He's in pest control. Eric?
What's up, Adam?
You're in pest control?
Yeah, I've been in it for quite a long time.
What can we do to get rid of the spiders?
Well, the sonic things don't work for any pests I've found.
I know, because I don't think they have ears, do they?
Well, they supposedly feel the vibrations. No, they don't have an ear like we do.
Mm-hmm.
But what you want to do is hire a professional to take care of the outside.
Yeah.
You put down a good perimeter on the outside. You cut down the webs when you see them with a broom.
Right.
And over maybe a couple of weeks or so, then you'll start seeing the feeding source, you know, the crickets, the other things they feed on. When you kill those off, the spiders are going to go because they're not going to have anything to eat.
Well, I do have somebody come by the house. In the commercial, it's an invisible force field that surrounds your house and then locks at the bottom like a giant padlock, clank, and everything. The reality is you got a Mexican guy takes half a lap around your house while he's smoking and shooting God knows what out of a Hudson sprayer all over your dog.
Well, can I ask?
That's really how, that's the reality of the exterminator. Now, in the commercial, it's an airtight vacuum that's sealed, a noose going around the neck of the roach. It gets tightened. The reality is an illegal comes by and sprays poison all over your pet and then leaves.
Can I ask the exterminator? You make good sense. You get rid of the prey and then you get rid of the predators. But Adam has two newborns, and I imagine this stuff is pretty toxic.
Well, that's why you stick with treating the outside as opposed to going the inside and spraying the baseboard.
I mean, but what about traps for spiders? Why can't somebody come up with a poison or a trap?
Well, those regular glue boards that you use for mice, even they were great. You
really?
Know, I've put them in houses and bases where they have.
I'm going to find one of the twins in there already eaten off his leg.
His little hand will be in there.
Little hand in the glue board.
Oh. Catch a couple twins in it, and you'll be good to go.
All right, so you say the glue board, sort of like the Roach Motel, but do spiders not go in for that stuff or go in for the baited stuff because they like to eat live prey? Like they sense movement, they sense activity in the web, and then they go down and eat the moth or the cricket or whatever. If you kill something, like if you left out an apple pie on your counter overnight, it's not like there'd be spiders on it,
right?
You know what I mean?
You knock down their webs, keep the webs knocked down, and keep them transient, so they're, you know, they're an arachnid, so they're crawling up above the poison. So they are difficult to treat, but if you get a good quality glue board, you put it in places where the kids aren't going to get to it, and then you keep the outside treated. If they're not doing their job, I'm going to
strap it to my head before I go to bed, that glue board. And here's the other thing. I don't know how the world was created. I don't know what the Almighty had in mind, but do we need this many goddamn spiders?
Apparently we do. What we need is women to turn it down a notch. I'll tell you that, man. My wife's
really?
The same way. It's zero. It's
more
zero,
you know.
That's so sweet.
Yeah, I'm just saying, do we need 700,000 varieties of spiders? And when they lay eggs, how about just giving birth to, like, 18, like the Mencia family? Do we need you to give birth in batches of 13, 1,400? You know what I mean? What do we really need these spiders for?
Well, you know, the female spiders, some varieties, do kill the male spider after mating. Am I right, sir?
Yes. I put them on hold, but I've seen enough Discovery Channel to agree with you. Rob?
Yeah.
You say a propane torch?
A propane torch is the only way to go. It's quick.
Mm-hmm.
It doesn't stink your house up like a poison does.
Mm-hmm.
And it's about $6.
Mm-hmm. So you're just saying next time I come in my bedroom at night after a couple glasses of red wine, ready to go to bed, and I see a big spider on the curtains, I bust out the plumber's torch and go to town.
Exactly.
Honey, hold still.
Curl up and they're gone.
Hold still, baby. Hold still. There's one right on top of that new comforter. Yeah, that sounds like an accident waiting to happen. But the torch would get rid of the web, which I could definitely go for. There is nothing more unnerving, by the way, than climbing in your automobile and seeing the big web. Every once in a while, you get the web inside the car, and now they violated your airspace. Like, okay, listen, I can deal with you in the den, I can deal with you in the kitchen, but in the car. And every once in a while, it comes hanging down from the visor while you're driving. You just freak out. Mm-hmm. It's in there.
Right in the face.
All right.
What the hell are you?
All right, so there's nothing we can do. Get a gecko lizard, spray poison, get a propane torch, and step on them.
Come on! Do it now!
We've learned nothing. Hey, by the way, here's the other thing, too. Why aren't we working on this? As we've talked about in the past, there's things we've signed off on. Hey, we're done with this. We're no longer working on it, and things we continue to evolve. There's a new laptop every 15 minutes. Why not get a nice something that eradicates spiders? Why not? Nobody likes it in their house. Every chick in the world is freaked out by it. People get bit by spiders. Even the guys who may not be freaked out by it certainly aren't any fans of it. Why in this day and age can we do no better than spraying some poison around the house? Work on that, Damashek.
Done and done.
And while you're at it, invent a toaster where the goddamn toast pops up past the hot metal rim of the toaster so I don't have to drag my hands or put my hand into the toaster and burn it on the edge to get my English muffin out.
Well, what am I going to... I am going to have to set aside the important work I'm doing on the plastic lid that goes on top of your coffee that you're allowed... that supposedly lets you drive while enjoying your coffee. But who could enjoy coffee out of that little sucky cup thing? That barely comes through. You can't enjoy it that way.
That's enough. Save it.
And it spills.
As I've said many times.
It doesn't even hold the coffee in.
Save it for the commercial break.
It's sad. One more time.
The only thing more annoying
than my voice is my laugh.
Lisa Lampanelli coming in next.
The Adam Carolla Show, where everyone's entitled to Adam's opinion.
I absolutely refuse to attend one of these sexual harassment meetings. The next time your company asks you to do this, say no. I'm not going to do it. I have work to do. And then go into the bathroom and masturbate.
Come on. All the cool kids are listening. It's the Adam Carolla Show.
This is what's wrong with America. This old piece of has a hot, blonde, younger wife. This is proof that money can buy good-looking. How dare you, sir? If you were broke, you'd be doing me. Hey, I know my limits. I can never get a hot-looking white guy. I can always get a chubby, ugly, disgusting white bastard. Or a hot black guy. I could get LL Cool J or Jared from Subway.
Well, that's Ann Coulter.
She is so much funnier than when she was on Leno.
And much hotter.
Yeah, you see her on those Face the Nation shows. She comes across a little bit dry.
Yeah.
But when she's doing her stand-up, she's on fire.
Dynamic.
Lisa Lampanelli in studio. Great to see you.
You too, babe.
Ann Coulter, who was supposed to be on the show about an hour and a half ago, is now on the phone as well. Ann?
Hello.
Hi, Ann. You're late, baby doll.
Somebody gave me the wrong number.
How did you get the right number? Just dialed randomly, eventually you got through to our show?
No, my publicist emailed it to me, I guess, after checking with you. But I am really tight on time right now because I already had it.
All right, well, get lost.
Oh, my God.
Did you really just hang up on Ann
yes.
Coulter?
Well, she's tight on time.
I agree with that. I completely agree with that.
Yeah,
you have no time. I'm tight on time. Good.
You're tight on time. I'm tight on time, too. And I don't have time for bitches, so let's move on.
That was the only interview with Ann Coulter that she didn't say something offensive.
Say it now. Tight on time.
You know what?
Go F yourself. You're tight on time.
I say this, Ann Coulter. Why the long face?
Listen, you bitch. Don't call in an hour and a half late and tell me you're tight on time. Of course you're tight on time. You're an hour and a half goddamn late calling into the radio show. Just take your crappy book and go pitch it to your stupid cable outlets. We'll do a fun show over
lying
here.
Lying whore. God, and I mean her. That in the best possible sense.
Oh, please.
She should die of cancer. That's all I'm saying. Don't mention cancer. We'll have to buy more rubber bracelets.
Someone was telling me those rubber, a friend of mine was explaining to me those rubber bracelets, the cancer fight, you know, yes. The Live Strong ones are so ubiquitous now. They're showing up on internet porn, and there's guys behind chicks like beating them in the ass, like, bitch, you love it. And there's the bracelet flopping around, and I'm like, what?
Strong living.
I got to think about testicular cancer while I'm trying to finish off here.
Maybe it's a bracelet to support anal.
That's brown, by the way. It's not yellow. Thank you. Great minds. Great minds. All I'm saying is if you're in the porn industry, and we have a lot of folks listening, strip off the crucifix. Let's go ahead and lose the cancer bracelet. Have the chick spit out her retainer. Let's really just clean a few things up. Put a little gaffer's tape over the hi mom tattoo. There's a few things I don't need to see in the porn. I don't want to see any heads. Stones in the background. I don't want to be thinking about cancer. Let's go ahead and strip. You know what? When you do a movie and you hold a Coke can, you hold your hand over the label so you don't piss off Coke. I'm just saying, when you're shooting porn, take the cancer bracelet
That's
off.
That's true. I think it's wrong that I got to buy every disease to match my outfits. What is that?
How many do you have?
Look,
there?
Mine aren't even diseases anymore. You know what I mean? I bought the sickle cell anemia for the blacks.
Right.
Mm-hmm. The SARS for the Asians. People. Yeah. Right. Yeah. And the Hispanics don't even have their own disease other than laziness. So, I mean, it's really... Does Carlos Mencia leave, I hope? Those dirty Hispanics. Anyway, I got... One of them is for that starvation one that Bono likes, that he loves them starving kids.
Right.
God, why don't they just eat the flies on their face? That's what I want to know.
Right.
They do it on Fear Factor. Use your resources, little Umbuku. I got a competing radio station's bracelet. I know, I feel terrible. You got one for your station, dude?
No.
I'll take that. All right.
Yeah, we should work something out. It does seem weird that this has taken the nation by storm.
Yeah.
These plastic yellow bracelets. But as far as Bono goes, Bono needs to, instead of coming here and harping on us that we should be giving more money to these places that don't have enough of it, how about you go over there and tell them to put on a goddamn condom every once in a while? You're at the wrong... You need to get to the source of the problem. We could just keep sending money that way, but I don't know what that would do. You need to get them to quit humping or pull out or put a condom on or do something, right?
Yeah, absolutely. I must admit. And when did these rock stars get a brain either?
Yeah.
You know what I mean? I'm sick and tired of that. You don't see Rod Stewart jumping around telling people what to do?
No, he's too busy humping blondes that are 35 years his junior. Yeah. And... You know, we always complain about rock stars doing drugs, but this is what happens when they don't. They end up like Bono.
Exactly. Stop being a do-gooder. And you know, I mean, I'm sick of that stuff. I'm sick of everybody preaching at us. I mean, Oprah. Are you sick of Oprah? Is she God yet? You know what I mean? No, she'll never be God. Why? Not because she's a woman, because she's black. And God hates blacks.
I cannot zip my fly up without my wife chiming in about something Oprah. She learned on Oprah.
Coming up, sex, sluts, and ecstasy.
Yeah, I learned that you're not supposed... Okay. You got to jiggle your ding-a-ling three times, but not five times. Oprah did a whole... Oprah does a special, evidently, on everything. Women who evidently don't have to work anymore sit home, absorb this cancerous poison,
absolutely,
and then regurgitate it at us when we get home from our day's work.
I worked two jobs, and I still find time to watch Oprah and Oprah After the Show on Oxygen.
Okay, you've got too much time on your hand. Get laid, bitch.
Yes.
Now, listen, come on, man.
You can help me with that. I mean,
I don't see how a broad who looks like you can't get laid. Look at you. You probably have standards.
Let's get some hookers and some coke and go crazy.
Lisa, if you knew some of the guys I dated, you realize I have no standards.
I don't either, but dude, I gotta tell you, it's rough out there.
Lisa, are you dating?
As a matter of fact, yes. I lost 25 pounds on Jenny Craig.
You did.
I must admit, I got a few more to go, but I'm getting in the game.
You do look fantastic. Yeah. What were you at your peak?
Oh, my God. No, years ago, I probably went a deuce 50.
Mm-hmm.
You know? So now I lost 25, so I'm probably at about a buck 90 right now.
Mm-hmm.
Wow, I can't believe I'm saying that on the air. But I am. I don't care. And let me tell you something, Adam, you're going to laugh.
The thinner I get, this is no lie, the lighter my dates get. I swear to you, I'm not lying to you. I dated a Hispanic for a little while, and now I have a white guy who's a stoner, but he has like very black features because he's always late and he's always smoking the pot, so that's very black, so it's within
eventually
my realm.
Eventually, you'll be at the Edgar Winter.
Absolutely, and albino in 2007 is my new campaign.
So you're saying
slogan.
As you lose weight, your dates become lighter.
The lighter I get,
lighter
the lighter the skin.
You're coming,
the guys
you're,
I get?
Guy's got pink eyes. And just a white, he's going to look like Gollum. Who's the guy from Lord of the Rings?
Or the Da Vinci Code guy.
Gandalf.
Gonna look like Gandalf.
It's so true. It's like weird. I still love the coloreds, though. I must admit.
Well, good,
that's your favorite.
Speaking of the coloreds, the Ed is on the phone. He's our caller from Vegas. He's a man of color.
Oh.
Ed.
Hey, Adam. Welcome back there, buddy.
Good to talk to you. Now, I know you're with a white woman, right?
What? I got married last Saturday.
Wow.
Congratulations. Yes.
But it was not to my girlfriend, and I'm in trouble about it. It's not, I don't know what to do.
Well, you know, we're talking to Lisa before the show about a little interracial love advice because nobody knows the chocolate and the vanilla like Lisa Lampanelli.
Absolutely.
Nobody's been to that ice cream store as many times as Lisa Lampanelli. Yeah.
That's why I'm nervous, because the lady I married is a white lady, and I ain't really been with too many white ladies.
Mm-hmm. Well, what can you expect?
No, what you can expect is a broad who'll shut her mouth, because you know what? Any white broad who dates a brother has low self-esteem and a big ass. Mm-hmm. So you know what? Keep that bitch in her place and smack her around if you have to. Do you hear me, Ed?
From your mouth to God's ear. Why aren't you doing more PSAs?
I was trying to. I'm about the fit children.
You a wild lady. I can tell. I hear you. I like that.
Yeah, you like that? You like that, don't you, baby? Oh, yeah.
Now, let me ask you this. What about Heidi Klum? She's got she has a small ass and probably self-esteem, and she's with Seal.
I feel Seal is very uppity. I must tell you.
He's a British accent. He doesn't count.
I've dated a black who went to Oxford. That's a whole different type of colored. They're not even colored. They're almost Asian.
Let me ask this about Seal. Maybe I'm not seeing it, but I don't find him to be an attractive
from the neck
black
down,
man.
He's hot. From the neck down, he's buffed out. But anybody with that kind of disease on the face, I don't mean to be racist about a disease, but I can't go for that.
Yes, I mean, you look at Rick Fox and you go, there's a good-looking brother. But you look at Seal and it's like, oh, he's a matinee idol. No, he has severe scarring on his face that probably wasn't that great before the severe scarring. No one ever brings it up. It's always just the beautiful couple.
Right.
It's one of these things that's kind of interesting. If you did bring it up, you would be racist.
Oh, yeah.
And you would be drawing out the attention apart that he's black and she's white, so no one ever says it. You know, we watch those entertainment shows, the beautiful couples on the red carpet, the beautiful handsome couples over here. I don't know. She's hot. He's scarred, right?
He's not even like, is he really even a musician? Like, he had one album, one song? Is he doing anything other than living off the model's money?
I don't know, but I think he gets a lot of mile. Yes, he had a hit album in 1991 or 89 or whatever it is. He gets no crap from anybody. He's considered an amazing artist, and he gets to boff the bejesus out of a smoking hot blonde chick and gets her knocked up, by the way, every 20 minutes.
Yeah. Oh, there it is.
That's
his one hit.
That's
right?
His one hit.
No, he had another one. He had a more fast-paced
hit. This is from Batman, right?
Well, oh.
Yes, this is the big
yes, hit. This is the one.
Now, what year? What year? Real early 90s?
Yet if what? Yet if a white guy worked once every 6 years, he'd be considered lazy, and we'd have to say it. But you can't say it about a black or an Asian. Oh, no, the Asians are very, you know, we can't talk about them. You're in trouble with them or something, right?
Yes, okay. We are.
Sorry about
we're
that.
Hot water with the Asians.
I don't think they even exist anymore.
Smart.
The most racist sound effect on earth. Good idea.
It's a gong. How dare you? That's from Emerson, Lake, and Palmer.
All right, let's...
What's wrong with you?
Yeah, that was... Carnival number 9. Don't you know classic rock? Thank you,
sorry,
baby doll.
Prog rock, biatch.
Lisa Lampanelli in studio. We'll take a break before she does any further damage with the Asian community. If you're a mixed couple or thinking about it, give us a call. She has interracial love advice for you. 866-901 Adam. News and sports coming up as well after this.
Can't get enough? Check out Adam on the web at adamcarolla.com.
I never got past high school math, so I'm not sure what pi is exactly, but any equation that involves dessert, I'm in for.
Adam will never run out of opinions. The Adam Carolla Show. Hey, coming up tomorrow morning on the Adam Carolla Show, we got the producer of Batman, Batman Returns, Caddyshack 2, Rain Man, and a whole lot more.
Teamwork sucks.
Peter Goober, and from Reno 911, Carlos Alizraki. That's Alizraki, not the other guy.
We are northbound on 395, Purple Lexus, Minnesota plate, IWD is dog.
It's a vanity plate.
It's a vanity plate. Yeah. Hold on. I would die for you.
What was that, Prince?
Hell, I don't know.
Give Adam a call at 866-901-ADAM. Now back to the Adam Carolla Show.
When I was growing up, there was this family that I'm convinced was only put on the planet to mock the Carollas because they loved each other so much and they were so rich and everyone was so good-looking. And every car they had a vanity plate that had the name of the family and then the number of the it was their name one, then the kid, the wife had two, and then the oldest son had three, and I used to just go up to their house up in the hills and just stare at those vanity plates and think, God, please let something fall on me right now. I really want to kill myself. I don't think vanity plates should even be legal.
No.
I don't like them. They're confusing. I don't like it when they have the name of the kid or the horse or the family and you have to do the math. And then when you're done doing the math, it doesn't mean anything to you because you don't know the family. They should be very accessible.
That's true.
They should be like those little caps on the bottom of the Lucky Lager where you flip the cap open after you crack the beer and you get to figure out the riddle.
I don't like when they brag about what they do for a profession either.
Yes.
Skin doc.
Yes.
Whatever. But how about the ones like this arbitrary thing that you can't have certain things on your vanity plate? Like I was on Penn Jillette's show the other day and they wouldn't let him buy No God because he's a big atheist. Why can't you buy No God? It doesn't make any sense. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Like if you don't believe in God, you should be able to
Can
put
you
that
get
on your thing.
I heart God? Is God allowed
yes,
at all?
Because you're allowed to heart God. You're not allowed to think God doesn't exist. Okay? So it's blatant agenda pushing. That was my Ann Coulter moment. I was just trying to add some political.
Lisa Lampanelli in studio, by the way, going to be at the Ontario Improv tonight through Sunday.
Yeah, son. Out in the suburbs. The white people.
Lisa was going to give a little interracial dating advice to some of the callers. Spanky?
Yes, this is me.
This is you?
Guys. Yeah.
Good. Good. You have a question for Lisa?
Yeah, my girlfriend's black and Portuguese, and she's a very money-hungry girl.
That's a shock.
I know what I'm looking forward to is she's going to have a big butt and a hairy lip because she's Portuguese and black. I need to know what I need to do.
You sound very racist, sir. I think you're dating this woman just to browbeat her, and I don't think you should be with this money-grubbing hooer. I think you should date someone with as stupid a name as you have and then go kill yourself.
Because you're obviously a racist individual.
How
there you
dare
go, Spanky.
You?
Thank you very much.
Or you could just kill yourself now.
I'm doing it right now. I'm choking myself.
Where do you live, stupid?
My Fresno, Tulare. Yeah, I'm actually choked. I just got busted yesterday for choking my chicken outside. I'm gonna go back out there and do it though.
Oh God, what? I hate him.
It's great stuff, Spanky.
I hate.
Again, you know, we complain a lot about no one able to speak English in this city. I say it's a blessing.
Absolutely.
Because Spanky speaks fine English, and we have to listen to him
what
and
Spanky
choke your chicken joke.
Did to the English language is probably what some of Lisa's boyfriends
here's
do.
Here's $10. Never call the show again. Jeff?
Yeah. Hey, what's up, Adam?
Do you have a question?
Yeah, I've been dating this black girl for about...
Yeah, well, that's a famous thing. That's like a Jew broad thing, too. And I would actually edit your language a little, sir. This is a radio program.
Well, hold on a second.
Hold on.
But you're right. Black women will not do that unless you hit the lottery, okay? So buy a ticket every week, buddy. But I don't blame them, because I date the brothers, and they won't do it either.
I had to
grow a chicken wing down there. I'm not going to lie to you. I dated a Hispanic. All I did was rummage around looking for spare change. Okay, I'm like, I got your peso right here, Pedro. So well, you can play that one over and over.
So your advice.
Because they don't have phones to complain.
Your advice then is to put a chicken wing.
I would say.
Down. You can say perform fellatio.
Or you could say perform the oral.
Cunnilingus.
You
could say,
Thank you. I'm very good at this editing.
By the way, Jack Silver is never here, but now he's in the room over there supervising, making sure that
he's the one with the. I'm not even the problem today. I didn't even do anything. Is he the guy with the glasses?
Yeah.
Harry Potter's retarded cousin. I got to look at that jerk all day. If I want a C block, I'll stay home. I hate him. I'm only kidding. Jew guy. Oh, my God. The Jews are always running everything. Is that okay to say?
No, just Hollywood.
I don't even mind.
Is he a Jew guy?
Silver.
I love you people, but they do have small members, man. Adam, the only thing shorter than a Jew's member is a black guy's to-do list. Just be honest. Right, Adam Carolla, my hero?
Thank you. Yes.
This advice is excellent.
I'm about the love. I'm about spreading the word.
I should tell that.
Hey, Jack, what's going down?
Easy's in there.
Oh, hey!
All right, we need to take a break. Lisa Leah Finelli. Is here. Here's the thing. Jack has a list of people that make him nervous.
Oh, am I at the top? I hope.
You're near the top. Actually, Damashek's at the top.
Wow.
You're second.
Oh, cool.
And so he hovers around like a retarded vulture every time one of the people on his list shows up.
Is Jack on the mic? Jack, you got to admit, we did good today. We didn't do nothing wrong other than the gong.
The next time I have to come in here, I'm cracking skulls.
Thank you, buddy.
Just trying to ride the dump butt.
Yeah, but see how nice I was? You didn't dump me once. You dumped all these other idiots, but not me.
We're just trying to save the license.
But I was a freaking professional Jew.
Let me come in there.
I will freaking kill you.
Sister.
I will give you a lap dance. You'll never walk again, you
little
bitch.
That's a hell of a lap.
I know.
I'll go right in there, sister. I'll break
He's
it down.
He's actually kind of cute. I'm kind of, like, happy now. I got sexually excited.
What about that? Would you do a Jew?
Yes, absolutely. Not him, but, you know, others. He's cute, though. Thank you, though, for being so thorough.
All right, Jack.
Suck up to
Leave
the
dump button alone and go take a dump. We're going to take a break. Lisa Lampanelli is going to hang out for the news, much to Jack Silver's delight. What's coming up in the news?
Well, I'm going to go down the list.
Oh, she's mad.
See? No problem there. Thank you. The Emmy Awards were announced. A lot of surprises and a few snubs. We'll review that. And what do George Bush, the Dalai Lama, 50 Cent, and Della Reese have in common?
Well, we'll find out answers to that and much, much more with Lisa Lampanelli and the news coming up after this.
Hey, this is the Adam Carolla Show.
Dave, if you drank a 12-pack, would you give Ben Roethlisberger a reach around? You could use your terrible towel to clean up.
Stay here because there's a lot more coming up.
It's the Adam Carolla Show. Call Adam Carolla now, 866-901-ADAM. I'm hungry.
Lisa Lampanelli in studio. She's going to be at the Ontario Improv tonight through Sunday. Now, she's going to hang with us during the news and sports, thankfully. And it's now time for Teresa Strasser and the news.
North Korea has 3 or 4 more missiles right now on launch pads, according to media reports from South Korea. These missiles are either the short or medium range, unlike the long range missile they fired the other day. The South Korean defense minister has warned that further tests are possible. President Bush commented on the situation, but we don't have that.
Listen, when it's the year 2006 and your country still has a north and a south, it's time to kill yourself as a nation. Number one. Number two, I'm tired of trying to sort out who's the good one and who's the bad one because the north were good over here, but in Vietnam, the south were bad. Here's the deal. Right. Whichever one of you does the most of the Korean barbecuing, we'll keep. The rest are gone. I don't know if the north or the south. I love that Korean barbecue. That's the side we keep. The other, you're out.
Well, the north side is communist. Run by Kim Jong-il.
I don't care if they do
the good ones.
I think they're the bad ones.
But if they do the lion's share of the barbecuing, they're in.
Do you want to hear what Bush had to say?
Let's hear what Bush had to say.
They're still analyzing, trying to figure out the intention of the North Korean leader as to why he would have fired the rocket and what they were trying to learn from it. One thing we have learned is that the rocket didn't stay up very long and tumbled into the sea, which which doesn't, frankly, diminish my desire to solve this problem.
They're stupid. You see, they're not smart like us. They can't make their missile work.
Okay, police in Berlin yesterday arrested two men on suspicion of placing soccer balls around the city with the spray-painted message, "Can you kick it?" The balls were filled with cement. And at least
It's funny to
Germans. And at least two people were injured kicking the cement balls.
Nazi humor.
I did "Can you F it" with cement vaginas out in Los Angeles.
Did anybody get hurt?
My lawyer said I can't talk about it because there's still some lawsuits out there. But I'll tell you once I got a lot to say about
okay,
this.
Good. Former Enron CEO, former Enron leader, Ken Lay, still dead.
Yeah.
Early autopsy reports showed that he died of coronary artery disease. That was what was originally suspected. Also, in civil suits against him, his victims cannot seek punitive damages as they had planned to do, because legally, you can't punish a dead man.
Well, also, he's not going to be convicted. I mean, when he gets to the pearly gates, he's not dragging that in his sack lunch.
That's right.
Because
he still had appeals, and so without being able to, because he died, his appeals are unused, which means legally on the books he is not convicted.
It is how you know there's no God. Just rich white guy rips off the little man his entire life and then dies in his sleep in his chalet in Aspen right before it's time
to
go to the joint.
Over and over again, just gets to go quietly.
The victims can sue for compensatory damages from his estate, but of course, Lay found some way of making it seem that he was out of money.
Right.
So even though he had three chalets in Aspen, out of money.
Well, I will say this, and I always have to clarify it. I will see you in hell, Ken Lay, but through a porthole where I'm safely from an air-conditioned spot. I will not be in hell with you. I have to clear that up, because I think when I've been saying I'll see you in hell for a long time, people assume I'm in hell, too.
Right.
No, I'll be viewing you through an aquarium like porthole while I watch you roast in hell.
Maybe like a baby monitor?
I'll use my baby monitor to hear you. I'll hear you in hell better.
Okay, the Emmy nominations were announced today by Brad Garrett and Julia Louis-Dreyfus.
The world's tallest man and the world's shortest woman had to get together.
That's
to
right.
Deliver this.
Had
to be 8 feet between their two heads.
And you love when they play Brad Garrett's announcement, and he does everything he can not to sound like his character on Everybody Loves Raymond.
Just do the goddamn Fred Monster, would you?
We think of you as only one thing. Your show on Fox is going to be nowhere.
Well,
trust me.
The Sopranos, a perennial nomination leader. Snubbed! They only got one nomination for Best Drama, but Gandolfini, Falco, all of the other actors who are amazing got nothing. Here is the nomination for all of the best dramas that are nominated for Emmys. This was announced this morning.
The nominations in the drama series category are Grey's Anatomy, House, The Sopranos, 24, and from TLC, The Adam Carolla Project.
Wow!
Congratulations, dude.
That doesn't sound like Brad Garrett, does it?
That piece of crap?
Oh. So sad.
Did it sound like there was a fire?
It sounded like
that
it would echo.
Was having
a
roast.
Let's talk about Pirates of the Caribbean, because I know Lisa Lampanelli.
It's not Caribbean, whore.
Whatever. I was going to say something
pronounce
nice
it correctly. No, you know I'm kidding with you.
I was going to say something nice about you.
Okay, all right, go ahead.
No, I'm not.
Come on, whore, talk to me.
See in hell through the baby monitor.
Yeah, hear you in hell.
Pirates of the
Caribbean.
Caribbean, although I think it can be pronounced both ways.
I think we have to ask a black.
It's always been Pirates of the Caribbean. That's how it's always been.
Pirates of the Caribbean, Dead Man's Chest.
Mm-hmm.
hits theaters the way I'm going to hit Lisa Lampanelli.
Yeah.
I'll enjoy that.
Johnny Depp was asked whether he based his character on Rolling Stone Keith Richards. Here's what he had to say yesterday on Good Morning America.
Yeah, I mean, partly. It's not an impression of Keith. It's more like it's just sort of like, you know, the essence of Keith, you know. What he sort of represents for me. There's a confidence that he has that's very unique.
Okay, you know what? I'm going to have to start getting mad at Johnny Depp the way I'm mad at Madonna. What's with the fake British accent? I used to like him. I used to want to bone him. Not anymore. It's all over between me and Johnny Depp. Thank you.
I'm sure he's crushed.
I'll tell you.
But isn't that retarded? Why do you get the freaking accent?
Johnny, are you sitting down? Okay, good.
Yeah, we got that problem.
Some pretty bad news. Lisa Lampanelli, yeah, heavy set queen of the road. She does not want after you, as it turns out.
You, yeah, no,
stick with the supermodels until this blows up. over. Hey, maybe she'll have a change of heart. Johnny, don't cry. Johnny, please, pull it together. Get out in front of the kids.
I went from heavy set, I think I'm down to just plain large and eats things. With boobs that hang. I think
well,
Johnny, don't do anything stupid, Johnny. Johnny, take the gun out of your mouth. Put the gun down. Johnny, I wasn't going to. I only told you because I thought you could handle it. Now, please, life will go on. I remember when I learned that Lisa Lampanelli. I remember when I found out that Mom's Mabley didn't want to F me. I was heartbroken for a while, but I got over it, and I learned to love again.
Well, I don't want to say that Johnny Depp's depressed.
Remember when Cheryl from Good Times, Shirley Hempel wasn't interested in you physically? Remember that day? I took it like a man. I was stoic. Now, I was first was denial. That was the first stage, and I know you're into that, Johnny. I know you don't believe me now, but soon acceptance and then healing.
Well, there are the stages of grief, the denial,
sure. When you the seven stages of Lampanelli not wanting to F you.
Yeah, the Kubler-Ross stages of grief. Yeah, I'm sure he's been giving away his possessions and turning a lamp on and off. Okay.
Well, let's hope he doesn't listen to this show on the internet.
I'll end with this. 50 Cent, George Bush, Sylvester Stallone, Dalai Lama, and Della Reese. What do they have in common?
Lampanelli doesn't want to F them.
I would have Della Reese.
What about 50 Cent?
Oh, absolutely.
Oh, yeah.
He's a hot chocolate daddy.
Yeah.
Well, it's all of their birthdays today.
Oh, really?
Happy birthday to one and all. I'm Teresa Strasser, and that's the news.
Oh, screw the sports. We're out of time.
Dave Damaschek's number one sports.
All right, we'll be back with more hot guys Lampanelli wouldn't have sex with. Jack Silver, not on the list. Sorry, Jack. Still in her crosshairs. We'll get to that after this.
This is C. Montgomery Burns. If you call Adam right now at 866-901-ADAM, it will be excellent.
This is the Adam Carolla Show.
This is Kevin Nealon. Give Adam a call at 1-866-901-ADAM.
My dad doesn't own a radio station, but the give Adam a call things that we play when Adam's trying to get the F off the air. Why don't we just say give Frosty, Heidi, and Frank a call since they'll be the next people to pick up the phone.
Good point.
I was listening to the best of with a lot of give Adam a call, and Adam is in his bathroom urinating in his sink. I certainly don't want the phone to ring now. I could spill on myself, you know? Maybe we got to figure out these give Adam a call ones, right? What is going on? Thank you. Lisa Lampanelli, the funniest woman this side of Margaret Cho.
Oh, God! Am I the only woman comic who has a non-gay following? Honestly,
that's interesting. No, Cho, honestly, Kathy Griffin.
They all have only the homos.
Wait,
love
Sarah
them.
Silverman, men no, love her.
Yeah. Well, but because she's hot. You know, okay, am I the only mediocre looking?
No, all female comics have a gay following.
But a gay component. But I would say, like, Sarah maybe has a 20% fag audience. I have, like, a 20% fag audience. Those rest have all homos.
Right.
100% cornholers for Margaret Cho and Kathy Griffin.
Yeah.
Lisa Lampanelli and Sarah Silverman, I think Sarah's funny and hot. So she gets hot guys. I get ugly fat guys in the audience, which I enjoy.
I would say as my gym coach at 110%. Cornholer. She wanted that extra. He tried to inspire the team. I don't know why he used that.
But people should go
see.
It's
a bad nickname for a team, by the way, the Cornholers. Huskers, no problem. Holers, we got a problem.
But people should go see Lisa Lampanelli because she is very funny.
And I'm really freaking dirty, so don't even get me started.
All right. Well, we'll be listening to you from our baby monitor in hell. Ontario Improv, that is tonight all the way through Sunday. Don't put it off. Go see her tonight.
Thanks,
Lisa Lampanelli. God bless you, baby doll.
Best.
Get thinner every time I see you.
I will.
We'll take ourselves an extendo 20-hour break or so. And I want to thank Carlos Mencia and Ann Coulter. What
a delight. By the way, Ann Coulter wants you to apologize.
Yeah.
Whatever.
Here's my apology. F you. All right. So until next time, it's Adam Carolla saying mahalo.